Thank you, Ryan. I am just delighted to have been asked to participate in this conversation. One of the things that I think is so important as we work and study and live together is to be sure that the work that we all do, we can find points of intersection. Some of the points of intersection that have been lifted up in this conversation along the topics of religion, race, and politics, things that, as Ryan said, we normally are discouraged from having conversation about, and that's partly one of the reasons that we continue to have problems is that we don't have the important and often difficult conversations around these topics. Our format tonight will be to allow each one of our community leaders to share a bit about themselves and their work with regard to the issue of youth violence here in Chicago. And particularly, we will give them each a moment to reflect on their own roles in addressing violence in their particular communities, and in particular, how their faith traditions have informed their approaches to these things. A little later, we're going to talk about also how political engagement may have played a role in all of these cases. They are involved with political leaders, but it's an important opportunity to discuss that type of engagement on the part of these faith leaders as well. So we will, again, to clarify for them, ask them to speak 3 to 5 minutes. We've got good time here to talk about their role in addressing youth violence in their communities, and also how their faith traditions have informed how they approach that work. None of us in this room is blind to the pandemic that really exists in our city and in other cities across the nation, but we live here in this city. Easter weekend, the news was once again full of stories, 9 killed, 36 wounded. We work hard. The people on this panel have devoted their lives to addressing these issues in our communities, and we need to hear from them, we need to engage them, and so I hope that in this space we will be honest, we will be open, we will be respectful with one another as we deal with issues that are very difficult at this intersection of religion, race, and politics as it affects the persistent trauma, and I believe it is trauma that's being imposed upon our young people and our families due to the violence. So, Father Pfleger, who is probably stretched so thin, we're so grateful to have him here tonight. He's involved in so many things, and can we just welcome him as he prepares to.
Thank you. I only have 3 to 5 minutes, so let me talk. First of all, I'm honored to be here with my brother Rami, who we've done many things together, and of course, Marcy Richards, who we've worked together on violence over the last couple of years in particular. Let me take it from maybe a different angle, is because my faith tradition roots me in fighting for violence and for social justice because of my leader is Jesus. And I believe that Jesus Christ was one of the most radical leaders that ever lived in this earth. I just believe that the problem is that the church has become the middleman that has redefined him into being a wimp. And so one of my jobs is to have the church regain its prophetic voice. I think the church has laryngitis. I think the church has stolen identity. And I think it's forgotten, and it's got caught up with somewhere between prosperity theology and feel-good theology. And that's why the church has been, in my mind, one of the biggest and most ineffective leaders in our country today, and responsible for the condition of our world. Just quickly saying, I can explain them later, but four things I think that I see as my job as a faith leader, particularly in regard to the violence, is that in our pews, we are called to raise up leaders, to raise up activists, and to raise up organizers, not to raise up an inbred society that looks on itself and feeds on itself and sees itself as being its end all. I believe that our job is to remember that our calling is to be agents of change, to be transformers of the world. What gives us authority, what makes us authentic and gives us credibility is not what we do on Sunday mornings, but what we do after we leave church. And if we don't do anything when we leave church, then everything we do on Sunday mornings is a mockery. Number two, I think we begin to see our community as our membership. It's not who sits in our pews, But everybody that lives around our community, when people ask me, well, how many members do you have at St. Sabina? I say now, it depends on how many are living presently in Auburn, Gresham, and Englewood, because that's my church. That's our membership. I believe that we must see our community, be committed to it, be at the service of it, and be able to care for the people in it. Number three, I believe that the church has failed tremendously in being the prophetic voice and lobbyist for the people. In other words, we should be the lobbyists for unemployment. When we hear in America that the unemployment is 6.7% in America, that tells me that Englewood and Auburn Gresham are obviously not part of America, because the unemployment in Auburn Gresham and Englewood is 25 to 35%.
Absolutely.
And so when I hear that, I say, well, what about Englewood? What about Lawndale? What about Auburn Gresham? Obviously, we're not considered part of America. So we have to be the lobbyists about the two worlds that we live in. We have to be lobbyists about the education system that has failed our young people. We have to be a lobbyist about an NRA that has made guns part of America's wardrobe to make us think guns make us safer, guns kill us. And we have to be a lobbyist to fight while we have bought and sold public officials. We have to be the lobbyists about things like, I know where I'm at, University of Chicago should be a trauma center. It should be right here at the University of Chicago Hospital. It's a shame and a scandal to me that we go from Christ Hospital to Stroger Hospital, and why University of Chicago is not a trauma center and many other hospitals. So we have to be the ones that fight about the neglect and the not just fight, as Dr. King said, of picking up those on the side of the road, but transforming what put them on the side of the road. So I think the church has to be the voice and the lobbyist for change. And finally, I think the church has to create programs that serve and care and love and respect our young people. In the last 3 hours, I know of three people that were shot at one part of the city. I just got a text within the last half hour, a person was killed at 83rd and Morgan. Violence is happening all around us while we have church.
Yeah.
And my problem is we have to care for our young brothers. 95% of the brothers in the street that we've demonized into being gang members want the same thing every single one of us want. A job, an opportunity for an education, and an opportunity to fulfill my dreams and my purpose. And if we do not fulfill that, the real killers are not the ones on the street with guns, but us who control society that put them in a position where they have nothing else to do but shoot one another because we robbed them of their destiny. I'll shut up.
Amen. Marcy Richards, would you care to share?
Before I begin, I'd like to take this opportunity to publicly thank Father Mike. Fierce Women of Faith is birthed out of a vision that Father Mike had because he believed in women. And I've never gotten an opportunity to say that to him, but I want to thank him publicly for allowing us to have Fierce Women. Concerning my faith, my father was a pastor. He was also a presiding bishop, but my mom worked with women in the church and in the community. My mom is 13 in our family, and she had 21 foster children, but she went around the community galvanizing women to pray and to encourage various mothers who were struggling at that time that their children can do better. So my mom was really instrumental in working with women. As I grew up, I learned how to work with women. Number one, Fierce Women of Faith, we actively engage in working with individuals within the community to increase peace. It's a very simple theology. We just want to increase peace within the communities, and we do that by a five mission plan. One is we want to advocate for public witness. There's a lack of public witness within the communities. One of the guys told us within the communities, he said, the reason why I rob people is because I know that no one will turn me in. So although people know what's going on in the communities, they won't turn them in. Number two, there's a lack of community activism. There's a grave lack of community activism around the issue of gun violence. We are there training advocates who make up these citizens accountable. Some kind of way, we've got to find a way to make people, hold them accountable for what they do. Number three, we pursue legislation. There's inadequate legislation. There's a dearth of creative thinking by politicians as to how to manage legislation. There's no neighbor in neighborhood anymore. people, our homes are now our refuge. So we're trying to drive enforcement by creating these peace zones every Tuesday at 10 o'clock. We're somewhere in the neighborhoods. We've gone from Evanston to Inglewood to Auburn Gresham to Chatham to Beverly to 35th in the Dan and Ronnie, 87th in the Dan and Ronnie. We're there every Tuesday, and we're in solidarity. We're praying. This interfaith, interracial group of women who have really become very instrumental in these communities, we're praying out different faith. It doesn't matter. We have rabbis that are praying. We have Christians that are praying. We have Muslims that are praying. We have Buddhists that are praying. We're there standing because we believe that as women, we can make a difference. In some kind of way, we've got to come together regardless of who we are and what we believe in. And we've got to say that this violence is touching everybody. And there is a universal language of peace that we all want. And finally, what we do is we're looking to deepen our partnership. And by that, we mean that we want to work with community organizations such as Rami, such as Father Mike, where we can come together to work with those youth who are affected by this violence to say there is a better way. There seems to be a common thread among these youth, and that is the sense of hopelessness. And we want to bring hope back into the communities.
Assalamu alaikum. Peace and blessings be upon you all. It's a great honor and privilege to be here. I want to thank the Office of Spiritual Life and Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago. Kind of an old stomping ground of sorts. I got my sociology degree here, and which was an experience in and of itself that I think brings into stark contrast this polarizing dialectical worlds that we live in terms and occupy here in and around the campus and just a mile or two east, south, or west and south and north of us. I would say this, it's beautiful listening to Father Mike. I could just kind of sit back into the church mode and just go to church with Father Mike and not say much of anything. I think he's been extraordinary inspiration for all of us, and I look to him as one of my mentors and people that I want to be like when I grow up. So thank you, Father Mike, and Sister Marcy. Your work is extraordinary, and so it's an honor to share the panel with you. I'll say this about myself and the organization. IMAN, Inner City Muslim Action Network, now is almost 2 decades old. It's 17 years old. We came together in the late 90s, mid-90s. And, you know, we do a range of things from providing a free community holistic health clinic that does everything from behavior health to, you know, general medicine, see everyone across the south, southwest side, southeast side from the west side that come through. We work, our set of services also include a tremendous amount of youth programming and work with the formerly incarcerated. We have a program called Green Reentry where formerly incarcerated are green retrofitting the many abandoned foreclosed buildings in the neighborhood and using that as a training and a program to, if you reclaim the neighborhoods from the crisis of foreclosures and predatory lending. And then, you know, alongside our services, we have a strong advocacy and organizing arm. We believe very profoundly in the need to build power and to build that power across religious, ethnic, and racial lines and to allow the Muslim community to continue to be at the foreground of trying to advocate and agitate for better policy from the grassroots up. And we believe in the community organizing philosophy that really the leaders are the best, who know the best answers for the solutions that are confronting them. And lastly, a big part of our work has been kind of the arts and the intersectionality of arts as a vehicle of expression, as a vehicle of mourning, if you will, as a vehicle of aspirations and hopes, and a vehicle that brings communities together. So IMAN takes the arts in urban communities very seriously. We put on pretty significant festivals, taking it to the streets and community cafes and things in Marquette Park. For me, the religious intersection with my own biography is this so much is that I was not brought up in a religious setting or household, and I came to an embrace of Islam very late in life, and it came through really what I saw on the ground. I mean, I was inspired to re-engage Islam as a faith that particularly in the American context, provided a historical and very powerful precedent to do three things that for me have been at the center of this type of work, particularly around youth violence, because in fact, that in many ways is what precipitated our formation in the mid-90s. And the first thing really is this, to connect the disconnected. The Muslim community, I come from a Palestinian family, one of the first, my mother was one of the first non-whites to live in Marquette Park at the time and come, was born in May of 1948 as she was migrating out. But later on, Palestinian communities started flowing into the South Side at the very same time. Finally, African-American families started moving in from that kind of finally pushing back the through the boundaries of Western and Ashland and landing into Chicagoland and Marquette Park. At the very same time, Latinos were moving in from Little Village, and so you had this intersection of pretty much poor, working poor, Latino, black folks, and Arab living together. And so at the time, the issues of, I came, and for me, that was a foreign world, but to find, 11-year-old Palestinian kids dealing crack for the Black Gangster Disciples at 2 a.m. in front of their apartment of predominantly immigrant parents who didn't speak a word of English was the reality that we were confronting. And it became profoundly apparent that the mosques were absolutely ill-equipped to deal with it, particularly the immigrant-run mosque at that time, who had imams who barely spoke the English, and that our communities were already a marginal community of a marginalized community, and so that it was absolutely a necessity to connect the disconnected, and Islam and particularly the faith tradition as it was expressed through organized and activists coming out of with the experience of the nation, coming out of Imam Muhammad's community, coming out of extraordinary history of activism from H.R.A.P. Brown down, demonstrated a phenomenal capacity for those on the margins to be able to connect with other marginalized communities within the faith. And that really became an extraordinary part of what anchored our work and our organization. The second thing was a force of agitation, right? The faith tradition became a framework to both bring people together, also across socioeconomic lines. I mean, Father Mike does this brilliantly in being able to bring people who have brought up with privilege to also challenge those sectors of the community to think about their faith commitments in terms of notions of equity and disparity. And the context for my work with Iman, my exploration of my faith at the time, that notion of agitating ourselves and one another, and often that agitation came alongside holding hands shoulder to shoulder with our brothers and sisters in the church and the synagogues, because that aspect of all of our traditions, I think, began to speak to the type of work that we were doing on the ground. Lastly, it was also a framework for a aspirational vision of what could be possible, the world as it could be, right? And that is still such a critical part of our work, because every day the doom and gloom, Father Mike, I don't know how you do it. I mean, today alone, by 11 a.m., I got 5 of those calls. And 3 of them were near-death type of situations. Literally, how are you doing? I want to kill myself was the response. And these are brothers right around my neighborhood. 2 nights ago, shooting right on the stoop. I mean, coming up right in the middle of the stoop, 6 o'clock, 73rd Maplewood, shoots a 13-year-old kid sitting right in front of his mother's house. That is the drama. That is the affliction. And it could lead people to an extraordinary moment of despair. And that's often all we see. But at the same time, as all of us know, our communities are filled with extraordinary people who are beautifully resilient, who are doing powerful things, who have a vivid imagination of what it could look like when we come together. And I think for me, the faith tradition and its ability to inspire us to continue to hold on to that vision and to celebrate it even in the midst of very dark and sometimes challenging times has been a critical part of my own formation.
As I listen to each of you, one of the things that strikes me first and foremost is this understanding of the necessity. You call it connecting the disconnected. You spoke of hope. You spoke of understanding that Jesus is love, that Jesus is an agitator to insist upon justice in our communities. What, and in particularly in academic communities like this, I recruit for the Divinity School, mm-hmm. and very often we have this specter of the South Side of Chicago mm-hmm. is not a safe place. People don't understand the nature of the problems that exist in this community. They don't understand the issues of race and poverty that are at play in the particularity of Chicago and the South Side. So when people who don't know these communities, our communities, are looking from the outside, what would you have to say to them about a way in terms of understanding this and the way in which Hyde Parkers and people who think, oh, that's not my community, that's over there, that's further south or further west, how can we better engage and help educate people about the real nature of the systemic nature of these particular problems?
I'd just say my standpoint is that we've got, when Rami talks about the disconnectedness, we've got to start with ourselves. It's amazing to me when nobody really gave a damn about violence in Chicago mm-hmm. until 20 babies from Newtown got killed. 20 babies from Newtown got killed, and all of a sudden, America begins to talk about violence and how horrific it is, and the gun issue, and people getting shot, and all this. I'm thinking, really? 509 people got killed in Chicago the year before, and nobody speaks about violence, and 20 white babies in Newtown, horrific tragedy, get killed, and now it's an issue on the table. That sent a horrible message to South and West sides and Southwest and the black and brown communities, saying that your lives don't count. Because it has not been an issue for America until white America was affected. And it still is that same way. Even though, I remember marching with a group of the Moms Movement and saying to a lady I was marching with, and I said, you've got to help me. I said, we're marching now because of the violence after Newtown, but all the violence has been going on in Chicago. I said, why now? Why only now? And she was very honest and very innocent, said to me, she said, Mike, she said, when I saw those babies from Newtown who were killed, I identified with them. They looked like my son, my daughter.
Right.
When I see a black or brown child killed in the south or the west side of Chicago,
absolutely.
I don't relate with that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh my God, do we realize how serious this mm-hmm. issue is in our society?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Every week at the end of, was it this week with George Zephanopoulos?
Yeah.
At the end of his show, they list all military who were killed the past week. All they do is list their names and their ages. They don't say whether they were black, white, brown, male, female, rich, poor, gay, straight, immaterial. They were American military, and the country should mourn. Until we get to a point that all children are children of America, whether black, white, brown, gay, straight, rich, poor, where they live, until we connect that mentality that we're a human family and that we should care. We live in our little islands, and until it looks like us or feels like us or talks like us, we get disconnected from that. And it doesn't have to be from North Shore to the South Side. It can be from Hyde Park to 63rd Street. Until we understand that we are in this thing together. I get so angry, Rami and Masi, when I hear something happen North Side, and the first comment is, things like that don't usually happen in our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. I get outraged. I'm going to break the TV. Because, in other words, I understand if it happens on 79, mm-hmm. but it shouldn't happen here. No, it shouldn't happen anywhere. Mm-hmm. And until we have that kind of connectedness and outrage, that human life is human life, and we, the Catholic Church is great on talking about saving all life in the womb, and I believe it. I am not for abortion. I am against abortion. But until we understand that once they get out of the womb, we have to care about human life the same way, we are aborting people every day and not caring about it because simply they don't look like, talk, or have the accent that I have.
Yes. I would only, add to that by saying that, I think specifically, if you get back to the question specifically about how do we present that perhaps to a constituency that is either connected to this particular institution or lives in Hyde Park? I think two levels. one, we can't insult people's intelligence. We got to be very real. This did not happen by accident. The distinctions and disparities, the dynamic, the phenomena that Father Mike is talking about, the ability to be able to, that disconnection where it's not my babies, I can't relate to them, didn't happen simply by some type of, you know, in Chicago at one point in sociology, we talked about kind of this ecological school, that things just evolve that way. But our neighborhoods were not the boundaries of our neighborhoods. If we know the history of Chicago, were not crafted that way, right? They were not arbitrarily crafted. It's not arbitrary that it is, you go to certain parts, I mean, go to Western, go to Dane. I mean, when you're landlocked in certain parts of the city, right? I mean, it's almost hard to even get to and get out of. And the neighborhoods themselves have an almost isolating, parochializing effect that separate people from one another. There was a point where the Gold Coast slum phenomena at least agitated people to have to see people who lived in utter disparity and almost antithetical to my lifestyle. At least I had to confront it. Now we can live in communities and not really see that every day and be completely disconnected from it and identify with them as almost another type of people, right? It becomes much more difficult when that young brother or sister who gets killed is living on your same block. Because now you are forced or agitated to have to think that, as I have to, that could be my daughter. I take that very seriously. I want to know everything that's happening on my block. I want to talk to the brothers that are dealing on the block. I want to have serious conversations because every time my girl has to ride her bike up and down my block, I'm looking like a hawk because I know it could happen any moment. And that type of living with that angst and anxiety, I think we need to, at the university level and setting and among this community, in fact, agitate us to critique and deconstruct that a little bit more and begin to think about what are the real type of both long-term, short-term solutions to confronting that more comfortable disparity that continues to exist, because the solutions aren't going to be easy for any of this stuff. Father Mike is doing it, you know, great activists are doing it, Sister Marcy's doing it, but it's going to require, as we all know, this extraordinary paradigm shift. The other thing, and I think that paradigm shift is not going to happen accidentally, it's going to happen, we're going to have to push and agitate for it because it's uncomfortable, and that's a piece. The second thing I would also say, on the flip side of that, this type of almost hysteria about going into certain neighborhoods, and you know, I've taught a lot of courses where I ask my students to go out into the neighborhoods. I mean, the reality is a young, you know, Caucasian male has really a lot less to worry about on 69th and Green than a young brother from the neighborhood. Right. And if you tell them to go, you can go, you know, there's a cafe now on 69th and Green, and I encourage you just go there. And there's a young brother, young white brother there, that you know, Phil, who's there every single day, right in Inglewood. And you go there, take your family, no bulletproof glass, you could sit there, you see people, neighbors talking, residents talking. It's one of the most beautiful environments. It's right in the heart of Inglewood, right in the midst of all that stuff. And I think it's critical for our students to go out into these communities, to live alongside, to challenge themselves, to have these types of conversations. So,
for me, I live in Inglewood. And one of the things that Father Mike said to me about a year ago, he says, Marcy, you've got to be intentional of going and having relationships with people in the North Shore area. And I was in Wilmette on yesterday, and I invited someone to my house, and they were questioning me about Inglewood and the people in Inglewood. And I said, well, look at me as a person who lives in Inglewood. Having eulogized some of my neighbors' children, which is really it's really hard, it's really sad. What do you say to a mother after her son is killed in front of my house? But I remember my neighbor, I remember this teenage kid, I remember a week before he had asked to mow my lawn, to cut my grass for some money. I didn't know the side of him that everyone was talking about when I had to eulogize him. The person that I knew was the person who wanted to change. So there are people who want to change. They just need, they need this opportunity. And so what I've done, to answer your question, I've become deliberate and intentional in engaging people in conversations about what we can do and what our responsibility is. And what I, what they've discovered and what people are discovering when they come to my house, I have a bullet hole in my house where they shot in my house. They barely missed me. And when they see this bullet hole, they said, how do you stay here? What do you do? How could you possibly be in this environment? But what I understand is that collectively, our voices collectively together, going into these communities and offering something other than what's there, you would find the most beautiful people that can really work together. It's amazing, the people that live in Englewood, in my neighborhood, in Auburn Gresham, and in these neighborhoods. They're beautiful individuals if we could just get to know them.
Mm-hmm. I want to pick up on something that you said, Marcy, about the kids who are dying, who are being shot at, who are facing the gang pressures. I think there's a lot of misconception mm-hmm. about why young people join gangs. I don't think it's any longer the case, like, oh yeah, I'm just gonna sign up mm-hmm. and join the club. Could any of you speak to the real pressures that face our young people and the kind of choices they are forced to make that sort of complicate understanding this dynamic of the retribution nature of gun violence and gangs, what are the forces that are at play in putting pressure on our young people to even be a part of these situations? The geography of our neighborhoods, the whole issue with shutting down schools and kids being afraid to cross certain geographical boundaries. Could you unpack some of that for us so that we have a better understanding of what's really at play here?
I'll talk about it a little bit, but I'll defer to Rami for a minute, because I can talk about Englewood in terms of people walk on certain side of the streets as a direct result, but I'll defer to you.
I mean, I would start with the systemic thing for a second, you know, mm-hmm. before, because I think that's so often left out. Mm-hmm. We almost kind of treat the, quote-unquote, as Father Mike alluded to, the gang banger as this kind of, you know, modern urban savage mm-hmm. that's this right. exotic specimen mm-hmm. that, you know, needs to be understood as to why do they do this? Mm-hmm. As opposed to, and that's such a convenient pivot, right? When the conversation is, I mean, these communities have been utterly abandoned, mm-hmm. disinvested Absolutely. In, mm-hmm. and devastated. Mm-hmm. And any infrastructure that even exists, because as anyone has worked in the city, you know, last couple decades knows, look, the gang structure in the 90s is almost diametrically opposed to what we're kind of dealing with right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it had its extraordinary violent moments, but a lot of us would have said, listen, when you were organizing the street in the 90s, you had to have one conversation that would affect probably right. 10 or 15 blocks.
Mm-hmm. Right.
One conversation. 15 blocks,
settled.
It was one shot caller. There was some semblance of structure, right? And there was a literature and there was a code. Now, we chose a policy, again, larger, rather than having this kind of broader systemic analysis about the factors that continue to precipitate this devastating violence, to kind of just deconstruct and go after all the leadership of these gangs and incarcerate them, use RICO laws, and we did that. But what did we leave behind, and what did we put in its place? Did we insert any other alternative structure? Because that structure, for many of the young people who identified with it, was the only structure that was a viable structure in their life trajectory. They weren't not going to get in school. They certainly weren't going to get in college. There weren't professionals from DeWitt, Anderson Consulting rushing down to the south and west side of Chicago to say, let me give you a chance, right? There wasn't that happening. I mean, dropping out of school, 13-50% graduate, you know, dropout rates, and left to who? So these gangs were picking them up. But when you dismembered their structures mm-hmm. and left them with absolutely nothing, and then again put nothing into that void, there was no equivalent of a reorganization of serious investment, right? We let a generation grow up with absolutely no leadership on the streets, relying on whatever little was coming back from the prison. And what you have now, quite frankly, in certain neighborhoods like around us, I mean, you can't find a kid that says, what's up, Mo, knows probably nothing about Blackstone literature or history. The GDs probably have very little connection to GD structure, right? These are a lot of times these sets on these blocks At least in Marquette Park and certain places further, you know, around there, I mean, they're going at it with one another, and oftentimes mm-hmm. it is, you know, over the most petty things that they're struggling with. Some of it is just pure economic survival, right? And a lot of it is pure homicidal. It's not simply homicidal, it is suicidal activity, mm-hmm. right? The other thing that Father Mike talked about, the NRA, every time now we see one of these killings, all of a sudden the NRA spokespeople want to convince us that they're interested in mental and behavior health, mm-hmm. right? That's the issue, that's the problem in America. Yet these kids, but when there is never a diagnosis, we get trauma after trauma. There is no counselors ever set into these neighborhoods. Right. I mean, kids getting killed in the middle of the day. Think about the psychic trauma, as you mentioned, that's happening. So you have kids that are traumatized, no leadership, no economic opportunities, 50% dropout rates, no prospects of any trajectory, meaningful trajectory. The little things, the calls to Father Mike, the calls to me at 2 a.m. for that job, the call to Marcy may be the last call they ever make before they just lose everything, every sense of hope they have. So we are dealing with some extraordinary circumstances that from just a systemic and sociological perspective, you would sit back and say, how on earth would it not lead
right.
to what we're seeing, right?
It should be worse.
And in many times, the only time we react, as Father Mike talked about, was, as you mentioned, Father Mike, when we begin to have the national conversation, we start seeing white babies die as well. Or when we start seeing kids who start gravitating out of that confinement policy that we have, because a lot of our intervention policy, a lot of our violence prevention policy, quite frankly, is a confinement policy. Mm-hmm. We want to confine right. the problem. The minute it starts spilling into Michigan Avenue, what happened the last couple summers, right? What I mean, we are tracing them down to the Red Line stop that they came from, to the west side where they came from, and there was a whole level, another level of anxiety mm-hmm. about this spilling out. But that's in my estimation, one of the serious problems is that we're not having a serious accountability conversation about the larger systemic reasons issues. Of yeah. violence.
Go ahead. No, I was just going to say also there is, in terms of the educational structure, when the school closings are there, I mean, honestly, would I bring my family or move into a community where I don't have the proper resources to take my child to school? So that's a big factor. But also there's a lot of misplaced anger in our community. We haven't determined how to channel anger into activism, you know, or something like that. And then we have like lack of healthy food stores.
Yeah.
I went into one of our food stores and grocery stores on the corner, and the meat was expired. The potato chips, the chips were expired. So I made a fuss about it. And so the next time I come in the store, they go, here she comes again. Well, yes, you're serving us. Mm-hmm. And we're eating this because we don't look at the expiration date and things like that. So there's the socioeconomic stagnation. We have all of that within our communities, which is a big problem.
And I think this is one of the things that absolutely drives me nuts when we're talking about education, public education, is that we are using this strategy of confinement. Mm-hmm. We're using tests and other things to try to address the difficulties that we're facing in our public education systems without addressing these particular systemic issues. And we are developing certain kinds of anxiety out of real ignorance mm-hmm. and out of fear not to address some of those things. So I think those systemic issues cover so many other mm-hmm. Concerns that we face in our communities. If we don't have, you just said, we want what everyone else
right.
wants, right? We want a roof over our heads, if kids aren't eating, if they're not feeling safe. I know that each of you work with organizations that have certain programmatic initiatives in place to address economic issues, to address, Father Pfleger, St. Sabina has a wonderful peace and nonviolence education program. You're both working with advocacy, mm-hmm. Safe zones, working with women. I love the notion of the transformative power of women and just that history mm-hmm. of advocacy by women. The holistic health initiative, you're even trying to beef up your behavioral health resources with IMAN. Could you each speak a little bit about these programmatic initiatives that you think are absolutely critical that maybe could serve as models for what other people could either get involved with or replicate within their own environment?
I'll start. We have what is called a neighborhood music and nonviolence. And what we're doing is we have, we're going to take music into the neighborhood while we train individuals as well in the community. This is about a year-long project. We're going to start it in June. And what we're doing is we have two schools, areas that we're looking at, and that's Austin and Inglewood. And what we've asked to volunteers to do to come up to work with us in terms of if you're educated in music, you can train voices. And then from there, we're going to train these kids. And music seems to be this, has this common goal in front of with all of us. And so we learned yesterday we were at a Cantor's concert on the north side, and what we understood from that concert is that they've agreed to come to work with us in these particular areas to train our the kids in these schools. And we're hoping that through this program, this year-long program, that we can see some benefits where music will kind of curtail some of this violence and establish some peace within the communities.
What we did with our Peace Breaker program, two years ago, we started up what I had done about 5 years ago and did done back in the 90s when it was so, the violence was so high. And I tell my church that Friday night seems to be the primary time when violence was taking place. We were going to start going out every Friday night again, because when we become absent landlords of our communities, then we should reap what it is we've sowed by not being there. So we went out every Friday night. And this one particular Friday night, we would go to the different sections where there was the most violence that had started up. And Isaiah Thomas happened to be with us that one Friday night. We're on a porch talking to a group of young brothers. And I said to them at that time, I said, what would it be if you brought the four main, I like to call them organizations of this neighborhood together? And we brought them together to all have a ball game and play against each other and have the rivalry be on the court rather than on the street. And immediately they said, someone's going to get shot, somebody's going to get killed, it's not going to happen. Isaiah said, I'm in. And so we kept talking, and they said, all right, you know, we'll do it if the other groups will do it. So we went talking to that group, the BDs, GDs, Stones, Kittleward, and asked them each to do it. We spent the whole summer building those relationships to bring them together. At the same time, Joaquin Noah from the Bulls was reaching out saying he wanted to help in some way. He said, I don't know anything about gangs. He says, my father was a tennis player, but I want to do something. And he was reaching out. I said, you get me some NBA players. We scheduled this game for September. Now, what's strange is we're going to bring all these brothers together. And everybody told us don't do it. The city backed out, so they wouldn't even send a health van over. Mm-hmm. Police department said they'd have nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. The archdiocese told me they wouldn't cover us insurance-wise, even though I said I already signed for it. And all the other churches in the neighborhood backed away from us and they wouldn't do it. Mm-hmm. The brother said to me, well, how do we know we're going to be safe? We want to make sure nobody else brings something in. If we don't bring anything, we don't bring anybody else bring something in. So I reached out to Louis Farcon, who's a friend of mine. I said, hey, I need 25, 30 of your guys to be there at the doors, wand everybody at the door. Our men from the church will handle everything on the inside. He said, you got him. He sent over 30 of his brothers. We had over 2,000 people in our gym, turned away hundreds on the outside, had these four organizations there. One of the guys was playing against a guy who shot him 6 months before. Mm-hmm. And now they're playing in this contact sport. Isaiah and Joaquin brought a bunch of NBA players down. NBA refs ref the game. The NBA players coached the game. We did not have one single problem, one incident, one fight in or on the street afterwards. Mm-hmm. We said that was the hook. We said, okay, now here, this was the hook to come to bring together. So we want to help you going forward this. Now, and since then, we continue to do 2 12-week leagues and a 6-week league during the year. Had our second peace tournament in last September. Now we've gone from 4 teams to 8 teams running these peace leagues during the year. No longer representative by different organizations anymore, but now we do a draft. So we have 8 teams, 80 players, on one team of 10 people. I know of one team that has 5 different gangs represented on one team. But they're a team now. They're all playing with each other. They want to win together. They want their self-respect, which we're trying to take it from the street, mm-hmm. to now self-respect in how you play ball and in winning in the tournament. So that happened kind of unconsciously, that natural bonding. And the ones we used to have to pick up and drive over now come on their own. And so now they feel free, and everybody knows don't touch any of the guys involved with the peace tournament. Mm-hmm. And the last 2 years, we've had about, and we still have no police involved. We've been bad, by the police just stopped by and talked about this. No police have come by at all. We still have a foreign nation of Islam that does our swanning at the doors every Monday night. These guys come in, it's a great atmosphere, it's a fun atmosphere. Since then, we put 160 of them. We said, well, this is just a hook to get them in. Now, we want to help you fulfill your dreams. So we put 160 of them through GED classes, 130 of them into jobs, helping them if they need food for their family, letting them know what society, what Rami was talking about, how society has abandoned them. Society has told them they are nothing, they are worth nothing, they're valueless, and these areas, which many times look like third world countries, in particular areas of our city, and then they want third world countries to turn out first class citizens, not going to happen. So our job is to say, how do we help them become and get brushed, I always say brush the dust off their dreams, and help them become who they want to be and who they were God called them to be. But it's those effort we've seen of these 260 young men involved in this. They're not out there shooting anymore. They're not out there being part of the violence anymore. In fact, and the reason I apologize when you see me texting up here, because I hate people to text in public, and I'm doing it, but I'm just having four different gang guys call me, tell me who the guy was that killed this guy. Please tell the police. So this is the kind of relationship we've been able to build now because they're helping us. We hired four gang leaders who are now peacemakers on the street every day. They work for us. And they work the street every day, and now they're trying to bring these other brothers to help them put back in place that structure, but with a different slant to it. And I everything I get, whether I get jobs, whether I get tickets to the Bulls game, whether we're taking, everything we do, I do for these four guys, because I want to have them be leaders. Right. And I want to build the structure back up. But again, brothers on the street want opportunities, want options. And until we give them that, to say that we want the violence, let me just end on this. I don't believe we want violence to end in Chicago or in America. Let me just be clear about that. Violence is a business. And there's a hell of a lot of people making money on violence. In the police and law enforcement, lawyers and programs and all kinds of money going out there. All we want to do, as Rami says, contain it. If it happens in certain areas so that France can put on their tourism side, don't go past 22nd Street. If we can keep in areas, and it doesn't go to Michigan Avenue, it doesn't go to the North Shore, it doesn't go to the North Side, and we can contain it, I don't think we really care if it ends, if we can just let people think that that's the areas you stay away from. And until we understand that these are jewels and gems in our areas that we have to develop, we have to love, we have to care, we have to give opportunity to, and if we don't take care of that, then it is going to roll out into your area, and your children are not going to be safe too, and when their children are not going to be safe, then they're going to start to care about it. Yes.
I wanted to say something because Father Mike, when he started this program, like a month after that, there were no homicides in that area when he started that peace tournament.
Before we bring the audience in, we do want to touch on this notion of political engagement. And I know each of you in your own work has had to deal with, how should we say, would you call it bought and sold political environment that we all know exists in Chicago. Could you speak to the ways in which you have attempted to work with public leaders and the successes and downfalls of some of those in efforts as well? And once you've spoken to that, we're going to open up the floor to conversation.
I can jump in. I think, you know, that is a critical part of the work. I mean, that's a critical part of the connecting the disconnected communities or connected communities that are often pitted against one another and experiencing kind of a lot of this in very isolated ways. I know much of our work, for instance, in that capacity has been invested in building a deep-rooted alliance among communities of color with a vision for a kind of a grassroots human rights framework that we begin to advocate for in Springfield, in the state legislature, in city council, around policies that are often sometimes seen as the black issue or the Latino issue, but producing a collective platform that begins to hold legislators accountable for how they begin to think about us as a power base. I'll show you a couple of things that I think have been, in my mind, the successes of that. And as long as it stays rooted, because if you don't build that power base and we're not constantly connected with one another, the process of politics, as we all know, has its own, you know, very fast-paced momentum that can unroot and disconnect people who even come from connected circumstances. But, you know, we have Senator Jackie Collins, for instance, that comes out of, you know, Father Mike's community, who has been an extraordinary champion for a lot of this stuff. We have now Senator Van Pelt, right, who's in state legislature, who comes out of an organizing context, who's working with us, who's advocating for stuff. Commissioner Jesus Garcia, who, I mean, this guy was hitting the pavement with us, in the ground with us, working, and not just on one particular issue, but advocating for those. And a lot of those wins, those political wins, those brothers and sisters have been now being winning some of these offices, partly because they built those alliances in communities of color. And that area and that arena is critical. I'll give you one particular example that I just have been struggling with the last several days. Senator Van Pelt, when she went down there partly as a response to kind of grassroots pressure, there was a tax break that was on the books for $600, if you remember, right, for hiring the formerly incarcerated. You know, lots of pressure, lots of, you know, pushing, and now that has expanded to businesses in the state of Illinois to, I believe, Father Mike, $1,500, right, per formerly incarcerated person that is hired in the state, and something close to 2,000 something on the federal level, right, of an exemption for each person that you hire. That's an extraordinary piece of legislation, but it will just sit on the books. I know, for instance, there's a almost $7 million contract in the works that we helped to try to push to being a big developer into the community to take up some of the foreclosed homes. And now many of the formerly incarcerated brothers are demanding that you utilize that piece of legislation, right? And this is where I think the intersectionality between grassroots community groups, the extraordinary bright minds and very privileged kind of trajectories that come out of institutions like University of Chicago, this is where they need to coalesce. Our business community should be, now that that legislation is on the book, we should be demanding that businesses find a way to enact that legislation. Because a lot of the type of, and or hold them accountable, or and agitate. We don't want to hear a word against your concern about the city, about violence in the city, unless we can demonstrate that you have a certain percentage of your workforce that is coming from these communities, that you're going out and recruiting and giving meaningful trajectories. And see, the thing that I think it boils down to, Father Mike, in organizing, we talk about self-interest, right? Until we begin to agitate for a broadened self-interest, and we are able to make the case that people see it in their self-interest. I got one brother on my block, a job, who was otherwise bound for the same drama that was happening at the end of the block. Now, he lives two houses away from me. That wasn't just, I love the brother, and I hug him, and he sits in my back, but that wasn't just an expression of altruism. That was in my, he now is probably the best employee in the place that he got the job and is on an upward trajectory, right? And every day he walks by me, what's up, Rami? And everyone on the block sees him holding down a job now for the last 3 years. And that was in my self-interest, right? Because I live on the same block with him, and I want that. And I think in our community, we need to demonstrate that policy and those in office can be effective advocates when they are agitated and pushed for collectively. I think the bad examples happen when we only hear from them during the election seasons. There's very little accountability on the ground to sustain the wins that sometimes we get, because for every one good piece of legislation, sometimes there's 25 bad pieces of legislation that criminalize communities, that pit them against one another. And we have to come to the realization that alone and isolated, we don't have the muscle to fight against it. And so that's my sense on the policy piece.
Okay. For us, we work mostly grassroots. We're going into the communities to ask people to work with their legislators, because we don't have, most of our community residents are not voting. So we're saying, get out there, vote. We're asking them to call their legislators. We were successful in, I think we got almost 60,000 signatures that we presented to the governor last April in terms of common sense gun legislation. However, it did not pass. So we're now working with our legislators on a new no guns in places of worship, in houses of worship. So it's important that we work with our legislators, but at the same time, if we can get individuals to call their legislators, we're the ones that's making the decisions. We're putting them in office. So if we can get them to work with us and calling their legislators, I think we will have more success.
And I think that we have to understand that we work with the alliances like Jackie Collins and the rest who are of like-mindedness and come out of the community. We also have to understand there's been a horrible switch, I think, that's taken place. And it was never more visibly evident to me than at the anniversary of the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. And we looked at that anniversary. Here was way up on the stairs, President Obama, President Clinton, I think President Carter was there. They were way up on the stairs, and the people were way down at the bottom out in the mall. And they were speaking to the people. And I said, wow, Dr. King must be really ticked off. Because 50 years ago, see, he is ticked off. 50 years ago, the March on Washington was people talking to the government. And now here it is, government talking to the people. And we have to understand, Paul Robeson made, Roosevelt told Robeson, make me do what's right. When President Obama got elected, we all got excited about him getting elected and thought that was it. That was only the beginning. And then we all pulled back. We don't want to go into conflict. We look like we're supporting him. No, he's the President of the United States. We've got to make him do it. And our problem today is that we're going to see change in systemic change out here in our communities. We've got to make the elected officials accountable to the community. And if we don't do that, we can't, there's an apathy and overwhelmingness that people just don't vote because they become so hopeless, we all talk about. But the reality is we have to drive people to get agitated, get outraged, and decide we are not going to allow you to come into an office and ignore our needs. So we have to put together an agenda that says if you're going to run for Senate, if you're going to run for Congress, if you're going to run for mayor, run for governor, these are our issues. And I don't care if you're Democrat, Republican, Independent, if you're a dog, if you're a member of a PETA organization, I don't care what you are. As long as you address these five issues, then we support you. But we're not going to run with parties, we're going to run with platforms and principles. And I think that's where today we have to begin to see that politics continues to do its thing on its own. And we're not making it do anything for the community.
Wow, we could just go on here. I'm raptured. I'm remembering that there's an audience out here who has questions. So we have the mic over here. Ryan will assist. So if you'd like to pose a question to the panel, make a comment, we invite you to do that now.
I think we should take a collection up for a budget for a new microphone for the University of Chicago in hard times.
Wow. Hi, my name is Susan Danzig. I grew up outside of Coney Island, and we had gangs. It was like a West Side Story without the music. And every once in a while, they'd have gang wars, and it was always over something stupid, like somebody looked at somebody's girlfriend or sister. And they would make an appointment to have this gang war. You know, it would be like Friday night, you know, in some vacant lot or something. And they came. And they brought tire irons and chains and baseball bats and switchblade and those were their weapons. Nobody ever brought a gun. And nobody I know died. They got broken arms and stitches and went to jail for a little bit, but nobody died. We need to do something about these guns. It's so crazy. And it just gets crazier. What happened in Georgia yesterday, I can't get my mind wrapped around it. You know, they bring guns everywhere, including churches
right,
and the airport.
Right.
That's insane to me. So that's one of my passionate issues is gun violence prevention. And the other thing I wanted to say is we were at at the church on Monday, and I got to thinking that what we need, and there may already be one that I don't know about, but there should be an anonymous hotline where everybody knows the phone number. Like we know the Empire Rug commercial phone number. We should know a hotline number, because, you know, you can't blame a kid for being afraid to snitch on somebody because, you know, his life is in the balance. So not everybody has your number to text that information to, but I think there needs to be a number, and everyone has to know it and use it.
Actually, there is a text line, and it's funny you mention that, because this morning I was on a conference call where they were saying, why isn't the city or the police department talking anymore about this anonymous text line? There actually is a text thing for anonymous thing that nobody knows about.
Yeah, I know. I read about that. Except that with a text, when you send a text, you know who sent it.
Well, no, it's the way it's set up is
unless you have a burner phone.
You can, supposedly the way it's set up. I'm not going to speak for the government. It's supposed to be set up that you cannot tell where the information comes from. But I don't know. But we're not telling anybody about it.
Right.
In terms of the gun issue, you're absolutely right. What happened in Georgia yesterday is something that as many other states want to push in this country. And the NRA has bought Congress. The NRA has convinced a massive amount of Americans, at least that are vocal, because that's not where the massive amount of Americans really are, but the vocal ones, that guns make us safer. There's no statistics to back that up. But the fact that they are so powerful and they are so rich, I'm really glad to see former Mayor Bloomberg is now putting $5 million into a plan. Pardon?
$500 million.
I want that kind of money. Yeah. Putting all this money in to fight this NRA. Mm-hmm. And we have to be able to fight it with a moral conscience, because the NRA has people afraid and has people, you know, thinking this is the only way that I can feel safe. And until we in the faith communities develop that moral conscience that changes that, they're going to continue to win.
I want to address this to Rami. I'm Reverend Alice Harper Jones. I'm the Associate Pastor, Kenwood United Church of Christ, for Social Justice. And the things that you have said, I've been saying this all along. The church needs to step up and do what they're supposed to do, you know, following the lead of Jesus Christ. But anyway, what my concern is, I look at PBS all the time, and I see all the fine things that the university is doing in the public schools, and that's great. But I'm wondering, isn't it possible to get some kind of way to extend some of that resource into the communities so we could, you know, somehow they could bring the communities together and develop some kind of way of providing employment and training and whatever is needed for our people? Because so many people have dropped out of school, as we know, and so, you know, there should be some kind of way that, you know, this university can provide those kind of services for our community. Is that possible?
That's distracted to me. Now I may surprise you and say I'm not a spokesperson for the University of Chicago.
Any of us can answer that.
But I will say this in fairness to, and obviously I have a critique of the university, and you know, I think some of the greatest critiques of the dynamic of the very complicated historical sets of relationships between entities like University of Chicago, and in Chicago it's University of Chicago, in New York it may be Columbia, but I mean this phenomena of some of the most elite institutions of higher learning that exist in metropolitan urban areas across the country produce almost this type of isolated fortress type dynamic with a larger kind of island, if you will, or ocean of poverty and disparity. Now, I think there's some extraordinary minds within these institutions and beautiful souls that have attempted to deal with that. There have been great programs that have come out of the University of Chicago that have attempted to really position and put students into the community. There have been sociologists that have come out, and Loiqua Kant came out of here, and you know, who probably provided one of the sharpest and most robust critique of urban poverty and disparity in the last 15, 20 years, I would say, alongside other sociologists and thinkers, because I think the university needs to continue to be agitated internally and externally to begin to think about this history. I mean, there was, and it's a deep history, going back to the Project Gangrene, when social scientists were involved with this East Side Disciples in a time, the Blackstone Rangers, and putting them in schools. Some may suggest, and people like Irving Spergel and others who were around here for many, many years at SSA, may suggest that really at the time there was some genuine attempt to provide some outlets, and the university got the backlash, and Ford got his first big prison sentence out of, you know, taking federal money that came through the city at the time, and the university was accused with trying to expedite gentrification around the neighborhood by abetting and aiding and working with the Stones at the time. So there's a rich history of different types of outreach. And I think it's going to continue to be more and more complicated as the university becomes a larger and larger real estate agent in not only Hyde Park, but Woodlawn and Kenwood. And I think we need to have to ask those very serious conversations and discussions in sociology departments and anthropology departments at SSA, is how are we moving the needle here on these types of issues? And how can, you know, why go study urban disparities and poverties halfway across the world and have leading anthropology departments that are sending their students, you know, to the remote areas of the South America and Africa, and they can't feel even comfortable going a mile outside the terrain of the university? I mean, there needs to be some real ongoing systemic critique about that. And I don't know what particular solution it is, what type of funding mechanism it is. I know when Rhymefest, a friend of ours, was running here in the 20th, and he, you know, part of his vision was to really work with and agitate University of Chicago to begin to think about what it's doing to begin to build upon and expand the programs. And I think that's really part of the job of those that are still connected very formally to the institution here and within the institution. And it's part of our job within the community also to realize that this is sometimes, it is not always a black and white. It is not just a blanket condemnation of the university. We need to provide solutions. We need to light those candles and not just curse the darkness. And I think that comes collectively, you know.
The last two questions went to Michael Pfleger and Rami Nashashibi. Does anyone have a question specifically for Marcenia Richards? Question for Reverend Richards, please. All right, fair enough.
Hi, my name is Kenneth Newman. I'm a native of Hyde Park. I'm involved in sports, and I've worked for CPS before at the old Pershing Road headquarters. And until the causes of violence and the gangs will not be ended until CPS builds the athletic fields, the stadiums that it's never built. Every suburban high school has its own stadium, and they have a lower teenage pregnancy rate, they have a higher graduation rate, and a lower dropout rate. And CPS has 60 high schools and 6 stadiums, plus one built by the Park District Gateway. And CPS needs another 24 stadiums and at least 6 indoor tracks for winter use. And those, when those types of facilities are built, we'll have a lot more people engaged, a lot more young people getting confidence through sports, and they won't take out their actions in gang activity and shootings and whatever. And I'm hoping that ministers will step up to the plate and start to understand that they have to speak from the pulpit on this situation. They haven't built a new stadium since before World War II. They ignored the Great Migration. They ignored all the European refugees coming here after World War II. And because of this, the city does not have the athletic facilities that every suburban area has. Thank you.
Hi, Marcenia. This question is specifically for you. My name is Adriana Christopoulos. I and some of my fellow teachers are here tonight. We're really interested in hearing what you guys had to say about youth violence, since we work in South Chicago, which is a little further south and east than the neighborhoods that you've been talking about. But I know I kind of keyed in on you talking about how you spoke with a lot of mothers in the community. And so I was wondering, in doing so, what I've seen in the middle school that I work in is that there's more talk amongst our female students than I thought kind of going in about gangs and different violence that they encounter and that they kind of spur in their communities. So in working with women empowerment, how often do you work with like teenage females in their relationships to gangs rather than just parents or males in their relations to gangs?
Oh, I should have, perhaps I should have mentioned, we work more closely with females because there are a lot of more females that are now actively engaged in gangs.
Right.
But we also have, in the arts too, is what Rami was saying. We engage the females in arts and dancing, and some of our females have gone to dance with Joffrey Ballet, things like that. And we take them, actually, people who are little girls who are dancing in the alleys. So we do talk to them, and we also try to get them jobs and things like that, as Rami said. So it's really twofold. We work with the mothers. The reason why we do try to engage the mothers is because oftentimes these mothers know what these kids are doing.
Right.
They're bringing those elements within their homes.
Right.
So we try to work with the mothers and try to get some directions as to how we can start engaging conversations. But we work a lot with the young girls because they are really having problems now.
Do you ever work in conjunction with the young girls and the young men at the same time in kind of bringing them together and talking about, I guess, like gender differences and how it plays out in violence in their communities?
We do because it's very necessary, especially in my community.
Yeah.
I went home the other day and it's probably about 100 youth standing on the block, and it was more girls than it was males. So we sometimes sit down and we have a conversation as to how, what's the difference and what, where the anger is, because we deal with the anger a lot, and how we can bring those two groups together. We do.
Cool. Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Myra Quadra. I'm a second year at UChicago. So all three of you lead really significant community-based work against violence, but more specifically, all three of you are faith-based leaders. But you haven't talked that specifically about how your specific religions inform your work with youth. So how do your specific religions inform your work with youth, and are they a key component to your programs? Thank you.
How do your faith religion traditions inform your work, which you spoke to at the beginning?
How do our faith traditions join us together?
Inform the work, I think.
Inform what? Well, I can tell you what, with mine, I think, you know, in 1966, when I was a junior in high school, and out of curiosity, rode my bike over to Marquette Park with two friends to hear about this guy, Martin Luther King, was marching through Marquette Park. And I watched over and saw two things I never forgot. One was I saw hate that I had never seen before. I actually rode down 71st Street past the Ku Klux Klan building on 71st and off of Tallman and Washtenaw, and then went over to Marquette Park and saw people that I knew, people that went to my church, people who were parents of my friends, and saw this hate and cars being turned over and burned and all this name calling and throwing of rocks and bottles, and I saw that. And then I saw Dr. King come through. And I saw him not respond to anything of what was going on around him. And I remember riding my bike home saying, there's something about this man. He's either crazy or he's got some kind of power I want to know about. And I began to study him. And everything I studied about, the reason I'm a minister today is because of Dr. King. Because Dr. King made it clear that he did what he did out of his faith. And believing that faith was central, that he did what he did because he said we can enact laws that will stop you from lynching, but we can't enact laws to make you love, and that has to come from the transformation of hearts. And I really believe that the faith community, the Muslim, Christian, Jew, whether it's the Quran, the Torah, or the Bible, all teach the same thing about the transformation of hearts and the love and the coming together of brother and sisterhood. So somebody asked me one time at Fisk University, well, can you do what you do and be a social worker? And I said, no, I can't do what I do and be a social worker, because I would quit at some time. I would become bitter or quit or give up. But my faith is what reminds me, first of all, that we win. I don't care how bad it looks, we win. Unless I wake up in the morning and God tells me he quit, and unless that happens, I know we win. And so my thing is that faith tells us that the power of evil and violence and hatred and racism is not more powerful. Sodom and Gomorrah were not destroyed because of evil. They were destroyed because 10 righteous people could not stand up. And when we begin to stand up in our righteousness, we can transform the society.
For me, I grew up in a home where my parents were from the South, and they didn't have like much of an education, so they were very adamant on us getting an education. But one of the things that they taught us was that we had to be very, we were confined in a way, because we had to really stick with our faith. And as a Christian, they taught us to pray, and they taught us to believe that God will change things no matter how it looks, that it may look this way today, but tomorrow things could possibly change. And then I met one of my Muslim sisters who were praying, and as we started praying together, and it was our faith that joined us together, that regardless of who we're praying to, we're praying for a change. And then I met a Jewish sister who had the same faith. She was praying, and I said, we're praying for the same things. And there's a documentary about some ladies in Liberia. The Pray the Devil Back to Hell.
Right.
And so I've been going around the city and the suburbs, actually, showing this documentary, Pray the Devil Back to Hell, because these ladies came together. Not only did they have an opportunity to address the community, they address legislators, they actually were instrumental in allowing the first female president to become in, because they were instrumental in getting the president out, because he was advocating for violence. So I just believe that through our faith, that it will sustain us. That I think, for me personally, I think that our faith is greater than whatever forces are that out there against us. I think our faith is greater than the gun violence. I think we need to come together collectively. And I think, as Father Mike said, we need to get out of our churches, go into these communities, and begin to address these issues. But I think our faith is much stronger than what is we're seeing. But are we asleep? Is that what you're saying? We're asleep. We need to just wake up. And once the ladies wake up, we can pray the devil out of hell, you know, or wherever he may be. I think we can do stuff. Back to him. Back to him. Thank you.
Keep him there.
But I just think we need to come together. And I don't think we could stop blaming people. I think we should just take a little bit upon ourselves to say, you know what, on Tuesdays at 10 o'clock, we're going to be out there with our pink rebozos on, and we're going to be praying, and we're going to be talking to these youth, and we're going to have more courage and more boldness than we think if we just get out there and try.
Every time I hear you talk, I just think of that documentary. And I think if you haven't seen that, I mean, we've used that.
Right.
It's one of the most powerful illustrations, I think, for people who think about the intersectionality of politics and faith and tradition and what groundedness can do. I mean, it transforms an entire country and even becomes a symbol and powerful metaphor for the entire continent. For me, you know, listening to Father Mike, listening to Marcy, I'm obviously coming out of a different camp. I'm not an imam. I'm not a pastor in that respect. But my tradition definitely informed me. But it was also, again, as I mentioned earlier, it was both were happening. Three things, quite frankly, were happening at the same time. I mean, I was doing the sociology stuff after I got into the community because I wanted to better understand this as well as tell another story that I was seeing as I was in the midst of this work. I was animated by a tradition initially. I'll be straightforward and honest. I mean, I come out of a radical community organizing tradition. I believed in agitation. I believed in movement for social justice. I mean, no Muslim, I think, that comes out of the context of American Islam has not been moved by the story of Malcolm, has not been moved by the story and vision of
people who fought for a dignity for people who have been deprived that dignity, and that vision of standing up and believing and enacting a kernel, precept in the Quranic message, which is in Arabic, لَقَدْ كَرَمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ, that God has endowed every human being with an innate form of dignity that should not be deprived from them, are stripped from them, rather, because of the social, political, cultural circumstances that they have been, you know, subjected to live in, and to be advocates, even if it means against your own self, for fighting for that dignity. And I think that, and that seeing that enacted among kind of the early Muslim community in America, and having the opportunity of actually touching some of the hands of the people who were in the trenches of that work, had a profound effect on me to think about the relevance of the intersection of organizing and spiritual tradition. I would say later in my evolution, it was that that opened my window up to a broader appreciation of spirituality. Mm-hmm. And it was only in the context of doing the work that I also see the need for this rootedness. Mm-hmm. And it was really Pentecostal preachers. It was rabbis who were in the trenches who began to broaden a framework for me and allow me to understand this kind of universal rootedness in this kind of transcendental love, right? That is also comes out of, if you love our brothers and sisters, you will fight for our brothers and sisters, because ultimately you know that we share the same fate, mm-hmm, and reality, and we are fighting collectively for the dignity of all of our communities. And I believe the faith traditions help to animate that and drive that, and for me, provide the solace that I often need because of the taxing of the type of work. So,
well, time draws us to a close. Is there one more question? We'll take one more, and then we really do have to wrap things up. Gentleman in the back.
How you doing? This is to the whole panel. My name is Mr. Herbert Dinkins. I was just like some guys on the street. I carried two guns everywhere I went. And a gentleman pulled me to the side and told me that the tough guy was one that could save a life, not take a life. Mm-hmm. And he also, the same gentleman that I'm talking about, also in 1985, we put a program together called Communication Among Brothers. The same thing was happening. But through that program, as Brother Rami said, the government used the RICO Racketeering Act against us. I had an indictment which was 300 and something pages, spent 3.5 years in the hole, 2 years visit missing, a year phone time going. And even though the government knew I couldn't deal with what they said, they found me guilty and gave me 30 to life. But through the grace of God, I'm back on the street. Now, this is my concern here. Even through that, even through all of that, right now I work with three organizations as a volunteer. One of them is called GOSO, which stands for Go Serve Others, who does communication, who does urban agriculture in the community. The other one is Battle on Wax, and I think it could help the lady. They take the students into the studio and help them record things. The other one is Brother Ron Gorney up front, who has Crossfire, and he deals with the organizations in the Latin King area. My thing is this, and even though I've been through all I've been through, I'm still on the street trying to do the same thing, save them lives. And the gentleman who taught me that for the information was Mr. Jeff Ford. All I'm asking for is that the panel allows these other organizations to become a part of them, whereas we really can help with the community, because I am still struggling with that on the street. I also work with a few organizations, not organizations, I'll say, as you say, gangs or whatever they are, in the Woodlawn community area. Half of them are Latin, GDs, the other half are Stones, or whatever, Vice Lords, or whatever. And like you say, there are things that they need, but one of the most things they need in the world is a mind change, because without this mind change, they don't change. And there's some things that they actually do need, and I'm asking, maybe later on we could sit and talk, and I have these people contact you, and we want to stay below the line. We don't want to be above the line. We're not looking for a head count. We're looking for a success count. And I do appreciate being here today to be able to speak.
Well, let's thank our panel, Father Michael Pfleger, Marcy Richards, and Rami Nashashibi. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I believe there's some sustenance that's been provided for us at the rear of the room. So thank you for coming.
Programming and work with the formerly incarcerated. We have a program called Green Reentry where formerly incarcerated are green retrofitting the many abandoned foreclosed buildings in the neighborhood and using that as a training and a program to, if you reclaim the neighborhoods from the crisis of foreclosures and predatory lending. And then, you know, alongside our services, we have a strong advocacy and organizing arm. We believe very profoundly in the need to build power and to build that power across religious, ethnic, and racial lines and to allow the Muslim community to continue to be at the foreground of trying to advocate and agitate for better policy from the grassroots up. And we believe in the community organizing philosophy that really the leaders are the best, who know the best answers for the solutions that are confronting them. And lastly, a big part of our work has been kind of the arts and the intersectionality of arts as a vehicle of expression, as a vehicle of mourning, if you will, as a vehicle of aspirations and hopes, and a vehicle that brings communities together. So IMAN takes the arts in urban communities very seriously. We put on pretty significant festivals, taking it to the streets and community cafes and things in Marquette Park. For me, the religious intersection with my own biography is this so much is that I was not brought up in a religious setting or household, and I came to an embrace of Islam very late in life, and it came through really what I saw on the ground. I mean, I was inspired to re-engage Islam as a faith that that particularly in the American context provided a historical and very powerful precedent to do three things that for me have been at the center of this type of work, particularly around youth violence, because in fact, that in many ways is what precipitated our formation in the mid-90s. And the first thing really is this, to connect the disconnected. The Muslim community, I come from a Palestinian family, one of the first, my mother was one of the first non-whites to live in Marquette Park at the time and come. Was born in May of 1948 as she was migrating out. But later on, Palestinian communities started flowing into the South Side at the very same time. Finally, African American families started moving in from that kind of finally pushing back the through the boundaries of Western and Ashland and landing into Chicagoland and Marquette Park at the very same time. Latinos were moving in from Little Village, and so you had this intersection of pretty much poor, working poor, Latino, black folks, and Arab living together. And so at the time, the issues of, you know, I came and for me that was a foreign world, but to find, you know, 11-year-old Palestinian kids dealing crack for the Black Gangster Disciples at 2 a.m. in front of their apartment of predominantly immigrant parents who didn't speak a word of English was the reality that we were confronting. And it became profoundly apparent that the mosques were absolutely ill-equipped to deal with it, particularly the immigrant-run mosque at that time, who had imams who barely spoke the English, and that our communities were already a marginal community of a marginalized community, and so that it was absolutely a necessity to connect the disconnected, and Islam and particularly the faith tradition as it was expressed through organizing the activists coming out of with the experience of the nation, coming out of Imam Muhammad's community, coming out of extraordinary history of activism from H.R.A.P. Brown down, demonstrated a phenomenal capacity for those on the margins to be able to connect with other marginalized communities within the faith. And that really became an extraordinary part of what anchored our work and our organization. The second thing was a force of agitation, right? The faith tradition became a framework to both bring people together, also across socioeconomic lines. I mean, Father Mike does this brilliantly in being able to bring people who have brought up with privilege to also challenge those sectors of the community to think about their faith commitments in terms of notions of equity and disparity. The context for my work with IMAN, my exploration of my faith at the time, that notion of agitating ourselves and one another
And often that agitation came alongside holding hands shoulder to shoulder with our brothers and sisters in the church and the synagogues, because that aspect of all of our traditions, I think, began to speak to the type of work that we were doing on the ground. Lastly, it was also a framework for a aspirational vision of what could be possible, the world as it could be, right? And that is still such a critical part of our work, because every day the doom and gloom, Father Mike, I don't know how you do it. I mean, today alone, by 11 a.m., I got five of those calls. And three of them were near-death type of situations. Literally, how are you doing? I want to kill myself was the response. And these are brothers right around my neighborhood. Two nights ago, shooting right on the stoop. I mean, coming up right in the middle of the stoop, 6 o'clock, 73rd Maplewood, shoots a 13-year-old kid sitting right in front of his mother's house. That is the drama. That is the affliction. And it could lead people to an extraordinary moment of despair. And that's often all we see. But at the same time, as all of us know, our communities are filled with extraordinary people who are beautifully resilient, who are doing powerful things, who have a vivid imagination of what it could look like when we come together. And I think for me, the faith tradition and its ability to inspire us to continue to hold on to that vision and to celebrate it, even in the midst of very dark and sometimes challenging times, has been a critical part of my own formation.
Listen to each of you, one of the things that strikes me first and foremost is this understanding of the necessity. You called it connecting the disconnected. You spoke of hope. You spoke of understanding that Jesus is love, that Jesus is an agitator to insist upon justice in our communities. What and in particularly in academic communities like this, I recruit for the Divinity School. Mm-hmm. And very often we have this specter of the South Side of Chicago is not a safe place. People don't understand the nature of the problems that exist in this community. They don't understand the issues of race and poverty that are at play in the particularity of Chicago and the South Side. So when people who don't know these communities, our communities, are looking from the outside, what would you have to say to them about a way in terms of understanding this and the way in which Hyde Parkers and people who think, oh, that's not my community, that's over there, that's further south or further west. How can we better engage and help educate people about the real nature of the systemic nature of these particular problems?
I'd say my standpoint is that we've got to, when Rami talks about the disconnectedness, we've got to start with ourselves. It's amazing to me when nobody really gave a damn about violence in Chicago until 20 babies from Newtown got killed. 20 babies from Newtown got killed, and all of a sudden, America begins to talk about violence and how horrific it is and the gun issue and people getting shot and all this. I'm thinking, really? 509 people got killed in Chicago the year before. And nobody speaks about violence, and 20 white babies in Newtown, horrific tragedy, get killed, and now it's an issue on the table. That sent a horrible message to South and West sides and Southwest and the black and brown communities, saying that your lives don't count, because it has not been an issue for America until white America was affected. And it still is that same way, even though I remember marching with a group of the Moms Movement and saying to a lady I was marching with, and I said, you've got to help me. I said, you know, we're marching now because of the violence after Newtown, but all the violence has been going on in Chicago. I said, you know, why now? Why only now? And she was very honest and very innocent, said to me, she said, Mike, she said, when I saw those babies from Newtown who were killed, I identified with them. They looked like my son, my daughter.
Right.
When I see a black or brown child killed in the south or the west side of Chicago,
absolutely,
I don't relate with that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh my God, do we realize how serious this issue is in our society?
Yes.
Every week at the end of, this week with George Zephanopoulos?
Yeah.
At the end of his show, they list all military who were killed the past week. All they do is list their names and their ages. They don't say whether they were black, white, brown, male, female, rich, poor, gay, straight, immaterial. They were American military, and the country should mourn. Until we get to a point that all children are children of America, whether black, white, brown, gay, straight, rich, poor, where they live, until we connect that mentality that we're a human family and that we should care, we live in our little islands. And until it looks like us or feels like us or talks like us, we get disconnected from that. And it doesn't have to be from North Shore to the South Side. It can be from Hyde Park to 63rd Street. You know, until we understand that we are in this thing together. I get so angry, Rami and Masi, when I hear something happen North Side, and the first comment is, things like that don't usually happen in our neighborhood. Mm-hmm. I get outraged. I want to break the TV. Because, well, in other words, I understand if it happens on 79, but it shouldn't happen here. No, it shouldn't happen anywhere. And until we have that kind of connectedness and outrage, that human life is human life, and we, you know, the Catholic Church is great on talking about saving all life in the womb, and I believe it. I am not for abortion. I am against abortion. But until we understand that once they get out of the womb, we have to care about human life the same way, we are aborting people every day and not caring about it because simply they don't look like, talk, or have the accent that I have.
Yes. I would only, you know, add to that by saying that, you know, I think specifically, if you get back to the question specifically about how do we present that perhaps to a constituency that is either connected to this particular institution or lives in Hyde Park, I think we have to, two levels. One, we can't insult people's intelligence. We got to be very real. This did not happen by accident. The distinctions and disparities, the dynamic, the phenomena that Father Mike is talking about, the ability to be able to, that disconnection where it's not my babies, I can't relate to them, didn't happen simply by some type of, you know, in Chicago at one point in sociology, we talked about kind of this ecological school, that things just evolve that way. But our neighborhoods were not the boundaries of our neighborhoods, if we know the history of Chicago, were not crafted that way, right? They were not arbitrarily crafted. It's not arbitrary that it is, you go to certain parts, I mean, go to Western, go to Dane. I mean, when you're landlocked in certain parts of the city, right? I mean, it's almost hard to even get to and get out of. And the neighborhoods themselves have an almost isolating, parochializing effect that separate people from one another. There was a point where the Gold Coast slum phenomena at least agitated people to have to see people who lived in utter disparity and almost antithetical to my lifestyle. At least I had to confront it. Now we can live in communities and not really see that every day and be completely disconnected from it and identify with them as almost another type of people, right? It becomes much more difficult when that young brother or sister who gets killed is living on your same block, because now you are forced or agitated to have to think that, as I have to, that could be my daughter. I take that very seriously. I want to know everything that's happening on my block. I want to talk to the brothers that are dealing on the block. I want to have serious conversations, because every time my girl has to ride her bike up and down my block, I'm looking like a hawk. And so that's my sense on the policy piece. Okay.
For us, we work mostly grassroots. We're going into the communities to ask people to work with their legislators, because we don't have, most of our community residents are not voting. So we're saying, get out there, vote. We're asking them to call their legislators. We were successful in, I think we got almost 60,000 signatures that we presented to the governor last April in terms of common sense gun legislation. However, it did not pass. So we're now working with our legislators on a new no guns in places of worship, in houses of worship. So it's important that we work with our legislators, but at the same time, if we can get individuals to call their legislators, we're the ones that's making the decisions. We're putting them in office. So if we can get them to work with us in calling their legislators, I think we will have more success.
And I think that we have to understand that we work with the alliances like Jackie Collins and the rest who are of like-mindedness and come out of the community. We also have to understand there's been a horrible switch that I think that's taken place, and it was never more visibly evident to me than at the anniversary of the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. And we looked at that anniversary, here was way up on the stairs, President Obama, President Clinton, I think President Carter was there. They were way up in the stairs, and the people were way down at the bottom out in the mall. And they were speaking to the people. And I said, wow, Dr. King must be really ticked off. Because 50 years ago, see, he is ticked off. 50 years ago, the March on Washington was people talking to the government. And now here it is, government talking to the people. And we have to understand, Paul Robeson made, what did, you know, Roosevelt tell Robeson, make me do what's right. When President Obama got elected, we all got excited about him getting elected and thought that was it. That was only the beginning. And then we all pulled back, we don't want to go to conflict, we look like we're supporting him. No, he's the President of the United States. We've got to make him do it. And our problem today is that we're going to see change in systemic change out here in our communities. We've got to make the elected officials accountable to the community. And if we don't do that, we can't, there's an apathy and an overwhelmingness that people just don't vote because they become so hopeless, we all talk about. But the reality is we have to drive people to get agitated, to get outraged, and decide we are not going to allow you to come into an office and ignore our needs. So we have to put together an agenda that says if you're going to run for Senate, if you're going to run for Congress, if you're going to run for mayor, run for governor, these are our issues. And I don't care if you're Democrat, Republican, Independent, if you're a dog, if you're a member of a PETA organization, I don't care what you are. As long as you address these five issues, then we support you. But we're not going to run with parties. We're going to run with platforms and principles. And I think that's where today we have to begin to see that politics continues to do its thing on its own. And we're not making it do anything for the community.
Wow, we could just go on here. I'm raptured. I'm remembering that there's an audience out here who has questions. So we have the mic over here. Ryan will assist. So if you'd like to pose a question to the panel, make a comment, we invite you to do that now.
I think we should take a collection up for a budget for a new microphone for the University of Chicago in hard times.
Wow. Hi, my name is Susan Danzig. I grew up outside of Coney Island, and we had gangs. It was like a West Side Story without the music. And every once in a while, they'd have gang wars, and it was always over something stupid, like somebody looked at somebody's girlfriend or sister. And they would make an appointment to have this gang war. You know, it would be like Friday night, you know, in some vacant lot or something. And they came. And they brought tire irons and chains and baseball bats and switchblade and those were their weapons. Nobody ever brought a gun. And nobody I know died. They got broken arms and stitches and went to jail for a little bit, but nobody died. We need to do something about these guns. It's so crazy. And it just gets crazier. What happened in Georgia yesterday, I can't get my mind wrapped around it. You know, they bring guns everywhere, including churches
right.
And the airport.
Right.
That's insane to me. So that's one of my passionate issues is gun violence prevention. And the other thing I wanted to say is we were at at the church on Monday, and I got to thinking that what we need, and there may already be one that I don't know about, but there should be an anonymous hotline where everybody knows the phone number. Like we know the Empire Rug commercial phone number. We should know a hotline number, because, you know, you can't blame a kid for being afraid to snitch on somebody because, you know, his life is in the balance. So not everybody has your number to text that information to, but I think there needs to be a number, and everyone has to know it and use it.
Actually, there is a text line, and it's funny you mention that, because this morning I was on a conference call where they're saying, why isn't the city or the police department talking anymore about this anonymous text line? There actually is a text thing for anonymous thing that they don't, nobody knows about.
Yeah, I know, I read about that, except that with a text, when you send a text, you know who sent it.
Well, no, it's, the way it's set up is...
Unless you have a burner phone.
Supposedly the way it's set up, I'm not gonna speak for the government. It's supposed to be set up that you cannot tell where the information come from. But I don't know, but we're not telling anybody about it.
Right.
In terms of the gun issue, you're absolutely right. What happened in Georgia yesterday is something that as many other states want to push in this country. And the NRA has bought Congress. The NRA has convinced a massive amount of Americans, at least that are vocal, because that's not where the massive amount of Americans really are, but the vocal ones, that guns make us safer. There's no statistics to back that up. But the fact that they are so powerful and they are so rich, I'm really glad to see former Mayor Bloomberg is now putting $5 million into a plan. Pardon?
$500
million. I want that kind of money. Putting all this money in to fight this NRA. And we have to be able to fight it with a moral conscience, because the NRA has people afraid. And has people, you know, thinking this is the only way that I can feel safe. And until we in the faith communities develop that moral conscience that changes that, they're going to continue to win.
I want to address this to Rami. I'm Reverend Alice Harper Jones. I'm the associate pastor, Kenwood United Church of Christ, for social justice. And the things that you have said, I've been saying this all along, the church needs to step up and do what they're supposed to do, you know, following the lead of Jesus Christ. But anyway, what my concern is, I look at PBS all the time, and I see all the fine things that the university is doing in the public schools, and that's great. But I'm wondering, isn't it possible to get some kind of way to extend some of that resource into the communities? So we could, you know, somehow they could bring the communities together and develop some kind of way of providing employment and training and whatever is needed for our people, because so many people have dropped out of school, as we know. And so, you know, there should be some kind of way that, you know, this university can provide those kind of services for our community. Is that possible?
I may surprise you and say I'm not a spokesperson for the University of Chicago. But I will say this in fairness to and obviously I have a critique of the university, and you know, I think some of the greatest critiques of the dynamic of the very complicated historical sets of relationships between entities like University of Chicago. And in Chicago, it's University of Chicago. In New York, it may be Columbia. But I mean, this phenomena of some of the most elite institutions of higher learning that exist in metropolitan urban areas across the country produce almost this type of isolated fortress type dynamic with a larger kind of island, if you will, or ocean of poverty and disparity. Now, I think there's some extraordinary minds within these institutions and beautiful souls that have attempted to deal with that. There have been great programs that have come out of the University of Chicago that have attempted to really position and put students into the community. There have been sociologists that have come out, and Loic Wakant came out of here, and you know, who probably provided one of the sharpest and most robust critique of urban poverty and disparity in the last 15, 20 years, I would say, alongside other sociologists and thinkers, because and I think the university needs to continue to be agitated and agitated internally and externally to begin to think about this history. I mean, there was, and it's a deep history, going back to the Project Gangrene when social scientists were involved with this East Side Disciples in a time, the Blackstone Rangers, and putting them in schools. Some may suggest, and people like Irving Spergel and others who were around here for many, many years at SSA, may suggest that really at the time there was some genuine attempt to provide some outlets, and the university got the backlash and Fort got his first big prison sentence out of, you know, taking federal money that came through the city at the time, and the university was accused with trying to expedite gentrification around the neighborhood by abetting and aiding and working with the Stones at the time. So there's a rich history of different types of outreach. And I think it's going to continue to be more and more complicated as the university becomes a larger and larger real estate agent in not only Hyde Park, but Woodlawn and Kenwood. And I think we need to have to ask those very serious conversations and discussions in sociology departments and anthropology departments at SSA is, how are we moving the needle here on these types of issues? And how can, you know, why go study urban disparities and poverties halfway across the world and have leading anthropology departments that are sending their students, you know, to the remote areas of the South America and Africa, and they can't feel even comfortable going a mile outside the terrain of the university? I mean, there needs to be some real ongoing systemic critique about that. And I don't know what particular solution it is, what type of funding mechanism it is. I know when Rhymefest, a friend of ours, was running here in the 20th, and he, you know, part of his vision was to really work with and agitate University of Chicago to begin to think about what it's doing to begin to build upon and expand the programs. And I think that's really part of the job of those that are still connected very formally to the institution here and within the institution. And it's part of our job within the community also to realize that this is sometimes, it is not always a black and white. It is not just a blanket condemnation of the university. We need to provide solutions. We need to light those candles and not just curse the darkness. And I think that comes collectively, you know.
The last two questions went to Michael Pfleger and Rami Nashashibi. Does anyone have a question specifically for Marcenia?
Because I know it could happen any moment. And that type of living with that angst and anxiety, I think we need to, at the university level and setting and among this community, in fact, agitate us to critique and deconstruct that a little bit more and begin to think about what are the real type of both long-term, short-term solutions to confronting that more comfortable disparity that continues to exist, because the solutions aren't going to be easy for any of this stuff. Father Mike is doing it, you know, great activists are doing it, Sister Marcy's doing it, but it's going to require, as we all know, this extraordinary paradigm shift. The other thing, and I think that paradigm shift is not going to happen accidentally, it's going to happen, we're going to have to push and agitate for it because it's uncomfortable, and that's a piece. The second thing I would also say, on the flip side of that, this type of almost hysteria about going into certain neighborhoods, and you know, I've taught a lot of courses where I ask my students to go out into the neighborhoods. I mean, the reality is a young Caucasian male has really a lot less to worry about on 69th and Green than a young brother from the neighborhood. And if you tell them to go, you can go, you know, there's a cafe now on 69th and Green, and I encourage you just go there. And there's a young white brother there, that, you know, Phil, who's there every single day, right in Inglewood. And you go there, take your family, no bulletproof glass, you could sit there, you see people, neighbors talking, residents talking. It's one of the most beautiful environments. It's right in the heart of Inglewood, right in the midst of all that stuff. And I think it's critical for our students to go out into these communities, to live alongside, to challenge themselves, to have these types of conversations. So,
for me, I live in Inglewood, and one of the things that Father Mike said to me about a year ago, he says, Marcy, you've got to be intentional of going and having relationships with people in the North Shore area. And I was in Wilmette on yesterday, and I invited someone to my house, and they were questioning me about Inglewood and the people in Inglewood. And I said, well, look at me as a person who lives in Inglewood. Having eulogize my some of my neighbors' children, which is really it's really hard. It's really sad. What do you say to a mother after her son is killed in front of my house? But I remember my neighbor. I remember this teenage kid. I remember a week before he had asked to mow my lawn, to cut my grass for some money. I didn't know the side of him that everyone was talking about when I had to eulogize him. The person that I knew was the person who wanted to change. So there are people who want to change. They just need, they need this opportunity. And so what I've done, to answer your question, I've become deliberate and intentional in engaging people in conversations about what we can do and what our responsibility is. And what I, what they've discovered and what people are discovering when they come to my house, I have a bullet hole in my house where they shot in my house. They barely missed me. And when they see this bullet hole, they said, how do you stay here? What do you do? How could you possibly be in this environment? But what I understand is that collectively, our voices collectively together, going into these communities and offering something other than what's there, you would find the most beautiful people that can really work together. It's amazing, the people that live in Englewood, in my neighborhood, in Auburn, Gresham, and in these neighborhoods. They're beautiful individuals if we could just get to know them.
Mm-hmm. I want to pick up on something that you said, Marcy, about the kids who are dying, who are being shot at, who are facing the gang pressures. I think there's a lot of misconception mm-hmm. about why young people join gangs. I don't think it's any longer the case, like, oh yeah, I'm just going to sign up and join the club. Could any of you speak to the real pressures that face our young people and the kind of choices they are forced to make that sort of complicate understanding this dynamic of the retribution nature of gun violence and gangs, what are the forces that are at play in putting pressure on our young people to even be a part of these situations? The geography of our neighborhoods, the whole issue with shutting down schools and kids being afraid to cross certain geographical boundaries. Could you unpack some of that for us so that we have a better understanding of what's really at play here?
I'll talk about it a little bit, but I'll sure. defer to Rami for a minute, because I can talk about Englewood in terms of people walk on certain side of the streets as a direct result, mm-hmm. but I'll defer to you.
I mean, I would start with the systemic thing for a second, you know, mm-hmm. before, because I think that's so often left out. Mm-hmm. We almost kind of treat the quote-unquote, as Father Mike alluded to, the gang banger as this kind of, you know, modern urban savage mm-hmm. that's this right. exotic specimen mm-hmm. that, you know, needs to be understood as to why do they do this? Mm-hmm. As opposed to, and that's such a convenient pivot, right? When the conversation is, I mean, these communities have been utterly, utterly abandoned, mm-hmm. disinvested Absolutely. In, mm-hmm. and devastated. Mm-hmm. And any infrastructure that even exists, because as anyone has worked in the city, you know, last couple decades knows, look, the gang structure in the 90s is almost diametrically opposed to what we're kind of dealing with right mm-hmm. now. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it had its extraordinary violent moments. But a lot of us would have said, listen, when you were organizing the street in the 90s, you had to have one conversation that would affect probably right. 10 or 15 blocks.
Mm-hmm. Right.
One conversation, 15 blocks,
settled.
It was one shot caller. There was some semblance of structure, right? And there was a literature and there was a code. Now, we chose a policy, again, larger, rather than having this kind of broader systemic analysis about the factors that continue to precipitate this devastating violence, to kind of just deconstruct and go after all the leadership of these gangs and incarcerate them, use RICO laws, and we did that. But what did we leave behind, and what did we put in its place? Did we insert any other alternative structure? Because that structure, for many of the young people who identified with it, was the only structure that was a viable structure in their life trajectory. They were not going to get in school. They certainly weren't going to get in college. There weren't professionals from Anderson Consulting rushing down to the south and west side of Chicago to say, let me give you a chance, right? There wasn't that happening. I mean, dropping out of school, 50% dropout rates, and left to who? So these gangs were picking them up. But when you dismembered their structures and left them with absolutely nothing, and then, again, put nothing into that void, no, There was no equivalent of a reorganization of serious investment, right? We let a generation grow up with absolutely no leadership on the streets, relying on whatever little was coming back from the prison. And what you have now, quite frankly, in certain neighborhoods like around us, I mean, you can't find a kid that says, "What's up, Mo?" knows probably nothing about Blackstone literature or history. The GDs probably have very little connection to GD structure, right? These are a lot of times these sets on these blocks, at least in Marquette Park and certain places further, you know, around there. I mean, they're going at it with one another, and oftentimes it is, you know, over the most petty things that they're struggling with. Some of it is just pure economic survival, right? And a lot of it is pure homicidal. It's not simply homicidal, it is suicidal activity, right? The other thing that Father Mike talked about, the NRA, every time now we see one of these killings, all of a sudden the NRA spokespeople want to convince us that they're interested in mental and behavior health, right? That's the issue. That's the problem in America. Yet these kids, but when there is never a diagnosis. We get trauma after trauma. There is no counselors ever set into these neighborhoods. Right. I mean, kids getting killed in the middle of the day. Think about the psychic trauma, as you mentioned, that's happening. So you have kids that are traumatized, no leadership, no economic opportunities, 50% dropout rates, no prospects of any trajectory, meaningful trajectory. The little things, the calls to Father Mike, the calls to me at 2 a.m. for that job, the call to Marcy may be the last call they ever make before they just lose everything, every sense of hope they have. So we are dealing with some extraordinary circumstances that from just a systemic and sociological perspective, you would sit back and say, how on earth would it not lead to what we're seeing, right?
It should be worse.
And in many times, the only time we react, as Father Mike talked about, was, as you mentioned, Father Mike, when it starts, when we begin to have the national conversation, we start seeing white babies die as well. Or when we start seeing kids who start gravitating out of that confinement policy that we have, because a lot of our intervention policy, a lot of our violence prevention policy, quite frankly, is a confinement policy. Yeah. We want to confine the problem. The minute it starts spilling into Michigan Avenue, what happened the last couple summers, right? What I mean, we are tracing them down to the Red Line stop that they came from, to the west side where they came from, and there was a whole level, another level of anxiety about this spilling out. But that's, in my estimation, one of the serious problems is that we're not having a serious accountability conversation about the larger systemic reasons of violence.
Go ahead. No, I was just going to say, also, there is, in terms of the educational structure, when the school closings are there, I mean, honestly, would I bring my family or move into a community where I don't have the proper resources to take my child to school? So that's a big factor. But also, there's a lot of misplaced anger in our community. We haven't determined how to channel anger into activism, you know, or something like that. And then we have, like, lack of healthy food stores. Yeah. I went into one of our food stores and grocery stores on the corner, and the meat was expired, the potato chips, the chips were expired. So I made a fuss about it. And so the next time I come in the store, they go, "Here she comes again." Well, yes, you're serving us, and we're eating this because we don't look at the expiration date and things like that. So there's the socioeconomic stagnation. We have all of that within our communities, which is a big problem.
And I think this is one of the things that absolutely drives me nuts when we're talking about education, public education, is that we're using this strategy of confinement. Mm-hmm. We're using tests and other things to try to address the difficulties that we're facing in our public education systems without addressing these particular systemic issues. And we are developing certain kinds of anxiety out of real ignorance and out of fear not to address some of those things. So I think those systemic issues cover so many other concerns that we face in our communities. If we don't have, you just said, we want what everyone else wants, right? Absolutely. We want a roof over our heads. If kids aren't eating, if they're not feeling safe. I know that each of you work with organizations that have certain programmatic initiatives in place to address economic issues, to address Father Pfleger St. Sabina has a wonderful peace and nonviolence education program.
You're both working with advocacy, safe zones, working with women. I love the notion of the transformative power of women and just that history of advocacy by women. The holistic health initiative, you're even trying to beef up your behavioral health resources with IMAN. Could you each speak a little bit about these programmatic initiatives that you think are absolutely critical that maybe could serve as models for what other people could either get involved with or replicate within their own environment?
I'll start. We have what is called a neighborhood music and nonviolence. And what we're doing is we're going to take music into the neighborhood while we train individuals as well in the community. This is about a year-long project. We're going to start it in June. And what we're doing is we have two schools, areas that we're looking at, and that's Austin and Inglewood. And what we've asked to volunteers to do to come up to work with us in terms of if you're educated in music, you can train voices. And then from there, we're going to train these kids. And music seems to be this, has this common goal in front of with all of us. And so we learned yesterday we were at a Cantor's concert on the north side, and what we understood from that concert is that they've agreed to come to work with us in these particular areas to train the kids in these schools. And we're hoping that through this program, this year-long program, that we can see some benefits where music will kind of curtail some of this violence and establish some peace within the communities.
What we did with our Peace Breaker program, two years ago, we started up what I had done about 5 years ago and did done back in the 90s when it was so, the violence was so high. And I tell my church that Friday night seems to be the primary time when violence was taking place. We were going to start going out every Friday night again because when we become absent landlords of our communities, then we should reap what it is we've sowed by not being there. So we went out every Friday night. And this one particular Friday night, we would go to the different sections where there was the most violence that had started up. And Isaiah Thomas happened to be with us that one Friday night. We're on a porch talking to a group of young brothers. And I said to them at that time, I said, what would it be if you brought the four main, I like to call them organizations of this neighborhood together? And we brought them together to all have a ball game and play against each other and have the rivalry be on the court rather than on the street. And immediately they said, someone's going to get shot, somebody's going to get killed, it's not going to happen. Isaiah said, I'm in. And so we kept talking, and they said, all right, we'll do it if the other groups will do it. So we went talking to that group, the BDs, GDs, Stones, Kittleward, and asked them each to do it. We spent the whole summer building those relationships to bring them together. At the same time, Joaquin Noah from the Bulls was reaching out saying he wanted to help in some way. He said, I don't know anything about gangs. He says, my father was a tennis player, but I want to do something. And he was reaching out. I said, you get me some NBA players. We scheduled this game for September. Now, what's strange is we're going to bring all these brothers together. And everybody told us don't do it. The city backed out, so they wouldn't even send a health van over. Mm-hmm. Police department said they'd have nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. The archdiocese told me they wouldn't cover us insurance-wise, even though I said I already signed for it. And all the other churches in the neighborhood backed away from us, and they wouldn't do it. Mm-hmm. The brother said to me, well, how do we know we're going to be safe? We want to make sure nobody else brings something in. If we don't bring anything, we don't bring anybody else bring something in. So I reached out to Louis Farrakhan, who's a friend of mine. I said, hey, I need 25, 30 of your guys to be there at the doors. Wand everybody at the door. Our men from the church will handle everything in the inside. He said, you got him. He sent over 30 of his brothers. We had over 2,000 people in our gym, turned away hundreds on the outside, had these four organizations there. One of the guys was playing into a guy who shot him 6 months before. Mm-hmm. And now they're playing in this contact sport. Isaiah and Joaquin brought a bunch of NBA players down. NBA refs ref the game. The NBA players coached the game. We did not have one single problem, one incident, one fight in or on the street afterwards. Mm-hmm. We said that was the hook. We said, okay, now here, this was the hook to come to bring together. So we want to help you going forward this. Now, and since then, we continue to do 2 12-week leagues and a 6-week league during the year. Had our second peace tournament in last September. Now we've gone from 4 teams to 8 teams running these peace leagues during the year. No longer representative by different organizations anymore, but now we do a draft. So we have 8 teams, 80 players, on one team of 10 people. I know of one team, there's five different gangs represented on one team. But they're a team now. They're all playing with each other. They want to win together. They want their self-respect, which we're trying to take it from the street, to now self-respect in how you play ball and in winning in the tournament. So that happened kind of unconsciously, that natural bonding. And the ones we used to have to pick up and drive over now come on their own. And so now they feel free, and everybody knows don't touch any of the guys involved with the peace tournament. And the last 2 years, we've had about, and we still have no police involved. We've been invited police, just stop by and talk about this. No police have come by at all. We still have a Foreign Nation of Islam that does our swanning at the doors every Monday night. These guys come in, it's a great atmosphere, it's a fun atmosphere. Since then, we put 160 in, we said, well, this is just a hook to get them in. Now we want to help you fulfill your dream. So we put 160 of them through GED classes, 130 of them into jobs, helping them if they need food for their family, letting them know what society, what Rami was talking about, how society has abandoned them. Mm-hmm. Society has told them they are nothing, they are worth nothing, they're valueless, and these areas, which many times look like third world countries, in particular areas of our city, and then they want third world countries to turn out first class citizens, not going to happen. So our job is to say, how do we help them become and get brushed, I always say brush the dust off their dreams and help them become who they want to be and who they were God called them to be. But it's those effort we've seen of these 260 young men involved in this, they're not out there shooting anymore. They're not out there being part of the violence anymore. In fact, and the reason I apologize when you see me texting up here, because I hate people that text in public, and I'm doing it. But I'm just having four different gang guys call me, tell me who the guy was that killed this guy. Please tell the police. Mm-hmm. So this is the kind of relationship we've been able to build now because they're helping us. We hired four gang leaders who are now peacemakers on the street every day. They work for us. And they work the street every day. And now they're trying to bring these other brothers to help them put back in place that structure, but with a different slant to it. And I everything I get, whether I get jobs, whether I get tickets to the Bulls game, whether I we're taking everything we do, I do for these four guys because I want to have them be leaders, right. And I want to build the structure back up. But again, brothers on the street want opportunities, want options, and until we give them that, to say that we want the violence, let me just end on this. I don't believe we want violence to end in Chicago or in America. Let me just be clear about that. Violence is a business. And there's a hell of a lot of people making money on violence. In the police and law enforcement, lawyers and programs and all kinds of money going out there. All we want to do, as Rami says, contain it. If it happens in certain areas so that France can put on their tourism side, don't go past 22nd Street. If we can keep in areas, and it doesn't go to Michigan Avenue, it doesn't go to the North Shore, it doesn't go to the North Side, and we can contain it, I don't think we really care if it ends, if we can just let people think that that's the areas you stay away from. And until we understand that these are jewels and gems in our areas that we have to develop, we have to love, we have to care, we have to give opportunity to, and if we don't take care of that, then it is going to roll out into your area, and your children are not going to be safe too, and when their children are not going to be safe, then they're going to start to care about it. Yes.
I wanted to say something because Father Mike, when he started this program, like a month after that, there were no homicides in that area when he started that peace tournament.
Before we bring the audience in, we do want to touch on this notion of political engagement. And I know each of you in your own work has had to deal with, would you call it bought and sold, political environment that we all know exists in Chicago. Could you speak to the ways in which you have attempted to work with public leaders and the successes and downfalls of some of those in efforts as well? And once you've spoken to that, we're going to open up the floor to conversation.
I can jump in. I think, you know, that is a critical part of the work. I mean, that's a critical part of the connecting the disconnected communities or connected communities that are often pitted against one another and experiencing kind of a lot of this in very isolated ways. I know much of our work, for instance, in that capacity has been invested in building a deep-rooted alliance among communities of color with a vision for a kind of a grassroots human rights framework that we begin to advocate for in Springfield, in the state legislature, in city council, around policies that are often sometimes seen as the black issue or the Latino issue, that, but producing a collective platform that begins to hold legislators accountable for how they begin to think about us as a power base. I'll show you a couple of things that I think have been, in my mind, the successes of that. And as long as it stays rooted, because if you don't build that power base and we're not constantly connected with one another, the process of politics, as we all know, has its own, you know, very fast-paced momentum that can unroot and disconnect people who even come from connected circumstances. But, you know, we have Senator Jackie Collins, for instance, that comes out of, you know, Father Mike's community, who has been an extraordinary champion for a lot of this stuff. We have now Senator Van Pelt, right, who's in state legislature, who comes out of an organizing context, who's working with us, who's advocating for stuff. Commissioner Jesus Garcia, who, I mean, this guy was hitting the pavement with us, in the ground with us, working, and not just on one particular issue, but advocating for those. And a lot of those wins, those political wins, those brothers and sisters have been now being winning some of these offices, partly because they built those alliances in communities of color. And that area and that arena is critical. I'll give you one particular example that I just have been struggling with the last several days. Senator Van Pelt, when she went down there partly as a response to kind of grassroots pressure, there was a tax break that was on the books for $600, if you remember, right, for hiring the formerly incarcerated. You know, lots of pressure, lots of, you know, pushing, and now that has expanded to businesses in the state of Illinois to, I believe, Father Mike, $1,500, right, per formerly incarcerated person that is hired in the state, and something close to 2,000 something on the federal level, right, of an exemption for each person that you hire. That's an extraordinary piece of legislation, but it will just sit on the books. I know, for instance, there's a almost $7 million contract in the works that we helped to try to push to bring a big developer into the community to take up some of the foreclosed homes. And now many of the formerly incarcerated brothers are demanding that you utilize that piece of legislation, right? And this is where I think the intersectionality between grassroots community groups, the extraordinary bright minds and very privileged kind of trajectories that come out of institutions like University of Chicago, this is where they need to coalesce. Our business community should be, now that that legislation is on the book, we should be demanding that businesses find a way to enact that legislation. Because a lot of the type of, and or hold them accountable. Or and agitate. We don't want to hear a word against your concern about the city, about violence in the city, unless we can demonstrate that you have a certain percentage of your workforce that is coming from these communities, that you're going out and recruiting and giving meaningful trajectories. And see, the thing that I think it boils down to, Father Mike, in organizing, we talk about self-interest, right? Until we begin to agitate for a broadened self-interest, and we are able to make the case that people see it in their self-interest. I got one brother on my block, a job, who was otherwise bound for the same drama that was happening at the end of the block. Now, he lives two houses away from me. That wasn't just, I love the brother, and I hug him, and he sits in my back, but that wasn't just an expression of altruism. That was in my, he now is probably the best employee in the place that he got the job and is on an upward trajectory, right? And every day he walks by me, what's up, Rami? And everyone on the block sees him holding down a job now for the last 3 years. And that was in my self-interest, right? Because I live on the same block with him, and I want that. And I think in our community, we need to demonstrate that policy and those in office can be effective advocates when they are agitated and pushed for collectively. I think the bad examples happen when we only hear from them during the election seasons. There's very little accountability on the ground to sustain the wins that sometimes we get, because for every one good piece of legislation, sometimes there's 25 bad pieces of legislation that criminalize communities, that pit them against one another. And we have to come to the realization that alone and isolated, we don't have the muscle to fight against it.
Thank you, Ryan. I am just delighted to have been asked to participate in this conversation. One of the things that I think is so important as we work and study and live together is to be sure that the work that we all do, we can find points of intersection. Some of the points of intersection that have been lifted up in this conversation along the topics of religion, race, and politics, things that, as Ryan said, we normally are discouraged from having conversation about, and that's partly one of the reasons that we continue to have problems is that we don't have the important and often difficult conversations around these topics. Our format tonight will be to allow each one of our community leaders to share a bit about themselves and their work with regard to the issue of youth violence here in Chicago. And particularly, we will give them each a moment to reflect on their own roles in addressing violence in their particular communities, and in particular, how their faith traditions have informed their approaches to these things. A little later, we're going to talk about also how political engagement may have played a role in all of these cases. They are involved with political leaders, but it's an important opportunity to discuss that type of engagement on the part of these faith leaders as well. So we will, again, to clarify for them, ask them to speak 3 to 5 minutes. We've got good time here to talk about their role in addressing youth violence in their communities, and also how their faith traditions have informed how they approach that work. None of us in this room is blind to the pandemic that really exists in our city and in other cities across the nation, but we live here in this city. Easter weekend, the news was once again full of stories, 9 killed, 36 wounded. We work hard. The people on this panel have devoted their lives to addressing these issues in our communities, and we need to hear from them, we need to engage them, and so I hope that in this space we will be honest, we will be open, we will be respectful with one another as we deal with issues that are very difficult at this intersection of religion, race, and politics as it affects the persistent trauma, and I believe it is trauma that's being imposed upon our young people and our families due to the violence. So, Father Pfleger, who is probably stretched so thin, we're so grateful to have him here tonight. He's involved in so many things, and can we just welcome him as he prepares?
Thank you. I only have 3 to 5 minutes, so let me talk. First of all, I'm honored to be here with my brother Rami, who we've done many things together, and of course, Marcy Richards, who we've worked together on violence over the last couple of years in particular. Let me take it from maybe a different angle, is because my faith tradition roots me in fighting for violence and for social justice because of my leader is Jesus. And I believe that Jesus Christ was one of the most radical leaders that ever lived in this earth. I just believe that the problem is that the church has become the middleman that has redefined him into being a wimp. And so one of my jobs is to have the church regain its prophetic voice. I think the church has laryngitis. I think the church has stolen identity. And I think it's forgotten, and it's got caught up with somewhere between prosperity theology and feel-good theology. And that's why the church has been, in my mind, one of the biggest and most ineffective leaders in our country today, and responsible for the condition of our world. Just quickly saying, I can explain them later, but four things I think that I see as my job as a faith leader, particularly in regard to the violence, is that in our pews, we are called to raise up leaders, to raise up activists, and to raise up organizers, not to raise up an inbred society that looks on itself and feeds on itself and sees itself as being its end all. I believe that our job is to remember that our calling is to be agents of change, to be transformers of the world. What gives us authority, what makes us authentic and gives us credibility is not what we do on Sunday mornings, but what we do after we leave church. And if we don't do anything when we leave church, then everything we do on Sunday mornings is a mockery. Number two, I think we begin to see our community as our membership. It's not who sits in our pews, But everybody that lives around our community, when people ask me, well, how many members do you have at St. Sabina? I say now, it depends on how many are living presently in Auburn, Gresham, and Englewood, because that's my church. That's our membership. I believe that we must see our community, be committed to it, be at the service of it, and be able to care for the people in it. Number three, I believe that the church has failed tremendously in being the prophetic voice and lobbyist for the people. In other words, we should be the lobbyists for unemployment. Mm. When we hear in America that the unemployment is 6.7% in America, that tells me that Englewood and Auburn Gresham are obviously not part of America, because the unemployment in Auburn Gresham and Englewood is 25 to 35%.
Absolutely.
And so when I hear that, I say, well, what about Englewood? What about Lawndale? What about Auburn Gresham? Obviously, we're not considered part of America. So we have to be the lobbyists about the two worlds that we live in. We have to be lobbyists about the education system that has failed our young people. We have to be a lobbyist about an NRA that has made guns part of America's wardrobe to make us think guns make us safer, guns kill us. And we have to be a lobbyist to fight while we have bought and sold public officials. We have to be the lobbyists about things like, I know where I'm at, University of Chicago should be a trauma center. It should be right here at the University of Chicago Hospital. It's a shame and a scandal to me that we go from Christ Hospital to Stroger Hospital, and why University of Chicago is not a trauma center and many other hospitals. So we have to be the ones that fight about the neglect and the not just fight, as Dr. King said, of picking up those on the side of the road, but transforming what put them on the side of the road. So I think the church has to be the voice and the lobbyist for change. And finally, I think the church has to create programs that serve and care and love and respect our young people. In the last 3 hours, I know three people that were shot at one part of the city. I just got a text within the last half hour, a person was killed at 83rd and Morgan. Violence is happening all around us while we have church. And my problem is we have to care for our young brothers. 95% of the brothers in the street that we've demonized into being gang members want the same thing every single one of us want. A job, an opportunity for an education, and an opportunity to fulfill my dreams and my purpose. And if we do not fulfill that, the real killers are not the ones on the street with guns, but us who control society that put them in a position where they have nothing else to do but shoot one another because we robbed them of their destiny. I'll shut up.
Amen. Marcy Richards, would you care to share?
Before I begin, I'd like to take this opportunity to publicly thank Father Mike. Fierce Women of Faith is birthed out of a vision that Father Mike had because he believed in women. And I've never gotten an opportunity to say that to him, but I want to thank him publicly for allowing us to have this. Concerning my faith, my father was a pastor. He was also a presiding bishop, but my mom worked with women in the church and in the community. My mom is 13 in our family, and she had 21 foster children, but she went around the community galvanizing women to pray and to encourage various mothers who were struggling at that time that their children can do better. So my mom was really instrumental in working with women. As I grew up, I learned how to work with women. Number one, Fierce Women of Faith, we actively engage in working with individuals within the community to increase peace. It's a very simple theology. We just want to increase peace within the communities, and we do that by a five mission plan. One is we want to advocate for public witness. There's a lack of public witness within the communities. One of the guys told us within the communities, he said, the reason why I rob people is because I know that no one will turn me in. So although people know what's going on in the communities, they won't turn them in. Number two, there's a lack of community activism. There's a grave lack of community activism around the issue of gun violence. We are there training advocates who make up these citizens accountable. Some kind of way, we've got to find a way to make people, hold them accountable for what they do. Number three, we pursue legislation. There's inadequate legislation. There's a dearth of creative thinking by politicians as to how to manage legislation. There's no neighbor in neighborhood anymore. people, our homes are now our refuge. So we're trying to drive enforcement by creating these peace zones every Tuesday at 10 o'clock. We're somewhere in the neighborhoods. We've gone from Evanston to Inglewood to Auburn Gresham to Chatham to Beverly to 35th in the Dan Ryan, 87th in the Dan Ryan. We're there every Tuesday, and we're in solidarity. We're praying. This interfaith, interracial group of women who have really become very instrumental in these communities, we're praying out different faith. It doesn't matter. We have rabbis that are praying. We have Christians that are praying. We have Muslims that are praying. We have Buddhists that are praying. We're there standing because we believe that as women, we can make a difference. In some kind of way, we've got to come together regardless of who we are and what we believe in. And we've got to say that this violence is touching everybody. And there is a universal language of peace that we all want. And finally, what we do is we're looking to deepen our partnership. And by that, we mean that we want to work with community organizations such as Rami, such as Father Mike, where we can come together to work with those youth who are affected by this violence to say there is a better way. There seems to be a common thread among these youth, and that is the sense of hopelessness, and we want to bring hope back into the communities.
Salaamu alaikum. Peace and blessings be upon you all. It's a great honor and privilege to be here. I want to thank the Office of Spiritual Life and Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago. Kind of an old stomping ground of sorts. I got my sociology degree here, and which was an experience in and of itself that I think brings into stark contrast this polarizing dialectical worlds that we live in terms and occupy here in and around the campus and just a mile or two east, south, our west and south and north of us. I would say this: it's beautiful listening to Father Mike. I could just kind of sit back into the church mode and just go to church with Father Mike and not say much of anything. I think he's been extraordinary inspiration for all of us, and I look to him as one of my mentors and people that I want to be like when I grow up. So thank you, Father Mike, and Sister Marcy. Your work is extraordinary, and so it's an honor to share the panel with you. I'll say this about myself and the organization. IMAN, Inner City Muslim Action Network, now is almost 2 decades old. It's 17 years old. We came together in the late 90s, mid-90s. And, you know, we do a range of things from providing a free community holistic health clinic that does everything from behavior health to, you know, general medicine, see everyone across the south, southwest side, southeast side from the west side that come through. We work, our set of services also include a tremendous amount of youth programs.